It starts with the first day of practice in August, and it ends today, the final day of the Illinois high school football season, and we start the slate of four state championship games with our Class 5A title between the Montini Broncos and the Morris Redskins, and a full day of football ahead as we take a look at the schedule with Class 6A through 8A to come as well, featuring a pair of unbeaten matchups between Cary Grove and Crete Moni, Lombard West against Lincoln Way East, and of course Mount Carmel here once again taking on the champions of the DVC, Lombard North. Hello everyone, welcome to Memorial Stadium here in Champaign on the campus of the University of Illinois. I'm Matt Rodewald, happy to be with you, and I think a lot of fans that are down here for both days are happy the wind has died down a little bit. The weather conditions won't be nearly as much of a factor. We have some titanic matchups for you today. Let's get things started as we send it upstairs and talk about our 5A matchup with Lee Hall and Jack McInerney. Gentlemen.
All right, Matt, thank you very much. Yeah, Jack McInerney, veteran IHSA football coach. You've coached in a state championship game before, and an old Marine guy, but this game kind of reminds you of a couple of other branches of the military service.
Well, it really
does.
I really believe this is going to be a battle for the 5A state championship. And what it is, it's a battle of the airborne of Montini versus the infantry of Morris. It should be a really a good football game.
Really looking forward to it. Montini going for four straight. Morris, a traditional power. Let's go ahead and send it back downstairs. No, we're going to go to break, and we'll be right back and preview today's 5A state championship game.
The big schools take center stage here at Memorial Stadium in Champaign as we get set for four final championship matchups here in Champaign. Matt Rodewald with you here at Memorial Stadium as we get set for Montini and the Broncos going for its fourth straight state championship, and the Redskins of Morris, the traditional power, here for the 10th time. Let's send it upstairs to Lee and Jack. Gentlemen.
All right, Matt, thank you very much. Yeah, it's a four-week-long road to Champaign, and we take a look at how this team got here. First, we begin with Montini. Two losses on the year for the Broncos. Easy win in game one against Bremen, but then Sycamore, that game went down to the wire. Last second play, they avenged an earlier loss this season to Marion Central, and then defeated Joliet Catholic on the Hilltoppers' home field. This guy's been here so often in Champaign, he needs his own parking place. Joe Borsellino.
He really is. His name is associated with Montini and state championships. The family's had great players, and he's one of the best. Now, right now, you're looking at a young man that I think could be the X factor in this ball game. He's the running back, puts up good stats. They're known for throwing the football, but I really think that the title could ride on his shoulders for Montini. And to me right now, there's the MVP of the team. When the quarterback goes down, he goes from wide receiver to quarterback. He did it last year. He's done it this year. He's their MVP. He's one heck of a football player.
All right, let's take a look at Morris's road to the Class 5A state championship game. The Redskins with a win over Rich East, no trouble with Urbana. Washington, that game was on the road for the Redskins. They had to go to overtime to beat Washington, and then a home game in the semifinals. They defeated Springfield Sacred Heart Griffin. They're a run-based team, and Reese Sobel is their leader.
Well, he really is a general of that infantry group we talked about in the open. He makes everything go for him. He's a real workhorse. And of course, now we're looking at Danny Friend. He's going to the University of Indiana. Opposing coaches call him a monster. He plays tight end and he plays outside linebacker. He's really a stud. And then now we have Anthony Munson. He really is the guy that they go to if they need a big score or a big first down through the air. He's an outstanding football player with excellent speed.
All right, the Montini Broncos going for a little history here today against Morris. They'll try to deny them in our 5A state championship game. Coming up next. And we are just about set to kick off our 5A state championship. Another full day of high school football here in Memorial Stadium. Let's go downstairs to Sophia Minert.
All season long, the Montini Broncos have broken every practice with the chant 4-peat. Coach Chris Andriano said the kids have not shied away from the pressure, and they are here today because they want to make history. Keep your eye on Joe Borsellino. He is playing today with a sprained right ankle. Matt, over to you.
Alan Thorson, the head coach of Morris, has a big responsibility being just 31 years old, and from down the road in Seneca, he understands the tradition. So when he got the job from George Durgo, he was just a college kid looking for work. 2005, as a sophomore head coach, he understands the last time the Morris team won a state championship, hoping to bring one home with his name on the title tonight.
All right, guys, thank you very much. We look forward to hearing from you throughout the game. Here are the gentlemen who will be calling the action here in Champaign. Thomas Fay, the referee, Andrew Special from Edwardsville, the linesman, Jeffrey Harris, Jay Smith, Kevin Wallace. Congratulations to them and best wishes to them on a day that's much cooler than it was yesterday, only 29 degrees. You can see the your breath in the air, the wind chill 19, but the winds much less than yesterday. Yesterday it was cooking out of the north at about 30 miles an hour.
I would kind of think Morris would have liked to have a lot of wind today. They would have kind of played into their hands, and of course, Montini, they prefer the kind of weather we have at this moment.
There you go. Look at Chris Andriano. 34 years, 215 career wins, 255 career wins, I should say, and four state titles, one in 04 and the last three in a row. And there you get a good look at Alan Thorson, the Morris Redskins coach. Their tradition goes all the way back to the 1980s. State championships in 1980, 1984, 2005. Nine state title game appearances for the Morris Redskins through the years. All right, we are set to kick off. Andrew Hart to kick it away for Montini. It's fielded at the five for Morris. That is Colin Grogan, takes it out to the 15, and he's brought down at the 17-yard line. And that's where the 12-1 Morris Redskins will start the day.
Well, field position is going to be a big factor for Morris today. Montini would like to see them have a shorter field because Morris loves to run the clock and run the football. And of course, as long as they're doing that, Montini's heralded passing game can't get out on the field.
Senior Zach Cinnamon at quarterback. There you see his numbers for the season. He is a transfer from Streeter. What a change for him. He was 0-18 in his years at Streeter, 12-1 playing for a state championship game, state championship here today. First give of the game is to Reese Sobel. Good run there on first down. And here's a look at our Buffalo Wild Wings starters for the Morris Redskins. And again, they come in 12-1. Perry, Grogan, Sobel, the running backs. Danny Friend at tight end. Anthony Munson, wide receiver for Morris. Up front, the big guys getting the work done. Claire, Lane, Miracle, Henry, Aldrich, and we mentioned Zach Cinnamon, number 15, 5'11", 175-pound senior. Second down and two for the Redskins. Sobel again met at the line of scrimmage and dropped for a loss, actually. Buffalo Wild Wings defensive starters for the Montini Broncos. Coming to this ball game, 11-2. Ruano, Bogart, Thompson, and Kennedy up in the trenches for Montini. Linebackers, Maduko, Sanzeri, and Nitti. And the secondary, Maloney, Starback, Mucha, and Josh Belt. Third and three now. I formation. Sobel gets the carry again. He's got first down yardage and more to the 40. Out across midfield, and he's going to be pushed out of bounds at the 28-yard line.
What a big run getting them out of bad field position early here for Morris. Nice job. You can see at the point of attack, just a zone lead. Lineman lock on. The fullback gets out in front. He just doesn't have enough speed to get past that safety, but this is an outstanding play. It shows you why that they are such a great rushing team. They get body on body, and this is what they're going to be trying to do all afternoon here. What a way to start the game for Morris.
45-yard pickup for Reese Sobel, the 5'11", 175-pound senior. First and 10 from the 32.
Ooh, on the ground.
Loose ball. Who's got it? Looks like Sobel might have it back.
Little anxious pulling out of center right there, trying to run the exact same play that got him down there. And Morris is very fortunate to get this back. You can see how he pulled out a little early, but they were able to get it back. This is a big play right here for Morris because they start out in their own territory in poor field position, but yet they get that big run. And right now they got Montini kind of reeling a little bit, and they have to go after him because when you got Montini on their heels, they better stay after him.
Broncos a bit of a slow starting team this year. Second down and 13 now. Cinnamon the handoff to Sobel. He tries to bounce it outside. Steps it up to the 30, pickup of about five there.
Now, what was crucial there, Lee, was that first down bobble. Morris is a type of team that first down is so very, very important for them. They need to pick up 4 to 5 yards on first down each and every time that they have that situation. And of course, on that very first play, they fumble the football, so that puts them in 2nd and 11, and that's not what they're used to.
Right. They want to be 3rd and 2 or 3,
exactly.
Not 3rd and 8. Right. That's where they are here, 3rd and 8. About 3 minutes into our 5A state championship game. Montini and Morris. Morris on the move. Cinnamon back to throw.
Screen.
Quick hit and just out of the reach of Anthony Monson.
That was just going to be a middle screen, and he was very fortunate that wasn't tipped into the hands of the linebackers from Montini. They dropped out rather quickly to get their depth in the linebacker drop, and he actually threw it over the head of the screen man. You can see it coming right at you. The center comes, is supposed to be out in front of the back right there, which he isn't. He's very fortunate that the linebackers didn't pick that off.
Well, now we'll see what happens. Go for it on fourth down.
This is a very unusual formation for Morris to see them in the spread formation.
Cinnamon, the lefty, pulls it, takes it himself. He's going to be short. He's brought down at the 25-yard line, and Montini will take over on downs.
That's a real big stop for Montini after that big play by Morris to get down in that position. You can see in the spread here, I don't really think he really wanted to throw it. This was a quarterback draw for the most part. There's his lead blocker right there. Nice job by the linebackers.
Well, you look at this Montini defense, they allow a lot of yards, they allow a lot of points, but they've somehow found a way to win. They do come up with the stop there after the big run by Reese Sobel that changed field position. And now Montini will go the other way.
This is a formation you're going to see the entire afternoon, spread formation 98% of the time. A lot of motion.
The handoff is to Taylor. And Dimitri Taylor still on his feet at the 40. He's across midfield. He could go all the way. The 20, the 10. Taylor takes it all the way to the house. 74-yard touchdown run by the senior Dimitri Taylor. They call him their secret weapon.
He really is a secret weapon. And as I mentioned in the open, I thought he was going to be the X factor, but I did not realize he was going to be X factor in the very first play of the ball game. Stretching out the defense right here. Good cutback right here. You can see the vision, the quickness, and then the overall speed that he has. Changes the ball to the other hand, and then just outruns the defense of Morris.
That's a 5A state championship record, longest rush, beating the record of 70 yards by J.R. Zwierzynski of Joliet Catholic.
Montini's big nemesis.
Hart for the point after is good, and it's a 7-0 Montini lead. It's a one-play drive of 74 yards, and it's Dimitri Taylor. 1,300 yards on the season and 74 big ones here in the 5A state championship game.
The IHSA state football finals are proudly presented by Country Financial.
We are back in Champaign, a very quick 7-0 lead for Montini over Morris. Let's go downstairs to Sophia Minter. Oh, let's not. We'll stay up here. And Dimitri Taylor, you talked about him in the open. And
he is a special player. And when you have a spread formation like they run out of, the threat that you need to have is a running back. Now, that really gives the spread formation true balance. There's many teams that have a lot of really good receivers and a good quarterback, but they don't have a running game to complement that offense. With Dimitri Taylor, Montini has that, so they have the full package to run that spread formation. And obviously on that first play, you can see why.
His 13th rushing touchdown of the season. Kick is away from Hart into the end zone, and that's an automatic touchback and high school ball. All right, I'm sorry, I was a little early on that one. Let's go downstairs now to Sophia Minter.
Lee, Chris Andriano said before the game that he thought that was going to be the matchup, was Montini's speed versus Morris's size up front. He also said, we're going to have to win this game in the big play department. He got both on Taylor's touchdown.
Boy, did he ever. Wow, that was an amazing run. And he just, once he got to about midfield, you kind of got that feeling that he had a chance to take it all the way to the house, and he did.
Well, he has that kind of speed. As you saw, Morris did not when he broke his. So they don't have the same speed on Morris's side that Montini does.
Redskins start from their own 20. Sobel gets outside.
Ooh, a flip.
There's a flag on the play.
Yeah, that was a tough block. It was a crack back. It wasn't designed initially to go wide. He wanted to come inside, and the wide receiver locked onto the defender who was trying to come up and make the play, and we got a clip on that particular play. That was a pretty easy call for the official to make.
Holding offense. 10-yard penalty for the spot of foul. Replay first down.
Right there's your hold. He's coming back, and he rides him all the way down. He's taking that Bronco for a ride. Results in a flag. Morse isn't going to beat Montini, in my estimation, by running wide. They might have that be part of the changeup, but they're going to have to run inside with their power football.
Cinnamon, play action, throws to Danny Friend. It's complete out near the 20-yard line. Danny Friend, as we mentioned, headed to the University of Indiana. All-stater.
Just a good little rollout. Friend is coming from the top side of your screen to the bottom on a drag route for the tight end. Good catch and good throw. But what this does, it just puts him back into the situation where they were. Now they have second and 10. But Danny Friend is a threat to be able to catch the football. He's not a threat to go a long way after the catch, but he's a big target to go to at 6'5".
Second and 11. Sobel, nowhere to go. Met at the line of scrimmage. Maybe a yard.
Game plans are designed to do certain things. Coaches come in, they scout teams, they have these game plans, but what they don't count on is to have a penalty on first down, which results then in having first and 20 or first and 25, and that's just something that you can't factor in. Then all of a sudden you got to go to your third and long plays, and you don't want to do that coming out of your own territory.
And that's happened to Morris on both possession so
exactly
far.
And they were able to luck out in that first possession to get that long run, but couldn't capitalize on it when they got into good territory. Morris is a little bit confused here.
Call a timeout on third and 10. Yeah, they moved the ball a little bit on this drive, but they still end up third and 10. That's not prime position.
It really isn't, and this is a game plan that plays right into Montini's hand. But the other part of this too is that Morris really needs to do a conservative play right here. But you know, both teams have had very tough opponents coming into this ball game, and I think what we'll see here is the schedules coming up. But that was a good shot of Friend. But you can see right here, this is what we're going to see all week long. And I'll tell you what, today is loaded, loaded with great teams and great games.
We've got Cary Grove and Crete Moni coming up next here, and then it's Glenbard West against Lincoln Way East. Glenbard North and the storied Mount Carmel program tap things off tonight. You see the scores from yesterday's action. Aurora Forsyth, Mercer County, Aurora Christian, Rochester all took home first place trophies yesterday here in Champaign. 7:09 to go here in the first quarter. It's 7-0 Montini, your lead.
Well, this has got to be a relatively conservative play, either a screen or a draw. I'd be really surprised if they go deep, because they're afraid to give up decent field position to Montini here. There's your screen.
Screen out to Sobel, and nothing doing there.
Montini's going to end up with excellent field position now on this punt. And also, let's keep this in mind. Montini could go after this. Here it is, nothing fancy here. You can see Borsellino just dropping out right there. It's just a little swing screen out to the edge. And Montini pretty well had that game planned in, knowing that that's probably what they were going to do. But this will be a big play. Take into consideration high school football. We've got to have a good snap here. And we've got to have a good kick. And the big thing to me is catch the football. Don't worry about the return. Catch the football. Anything after the catch is gravy.
Preston Miracle, the punt. It bounces near midfield. Almost hits a Morris player, and now does. And it will be Montini ball at about the 49-yard line in Morris territory. 28-yard punt for Preston Miracle.
Well, at this point, Morris is not real happy with what's going on in this first quarter. Montini is thrilled. This is exactly the opposite, the total complete opposite of what Morris wanted to have happen here in this first quarter. As far as taking the ball down the field, using the clock, driving the ball, Montini's got early breaks. And again, they got a good one here with field position. Let's see if they can take advantage of it.
Joe Borsellino is actually the quarterback who handed off to Taylor on that first play, the touchdown run. It's Now it's Gorgianis at quarterback, and they call this their three-headed monster. Three different guys will play quarterback, and they are so seamless in how they get back and forth in between quarterbacks. Our Buffalo Wild Wings starting lineup for Montini. At least this is how it'll start. Taylor, Tom Payne, Dusick, Borsellino, Gorgianis listed as wide receivers, but Borsellino and Gorgianis will also play quarterback. There you get a look at the guys up front. Now it's Wills at quarterback. He throws it out to Borsellino. On second and three, gets a first down. Buffalo Wild Wings defensive starters for the Redskins. Borsellino has a laugh after he gets hit, maybe late out of bounds. You can hear the crowd calling for a call there. Friend Miracle Grogan and Soper up front for Morris. Linebackers Countryman, Lincoln, and Perry. Perry the All-Stater. Hogan, McNellis, Madison, and Rickard in the defensive secondary. Montini, first and 10.
Excuse me. Montini has such excellent receivers that they're a threat on all the edges, which really opens it up for Taylor in the middle. But right there, Morris would have nothing to do with it.
Craig Clare, one of the co-captains, with the stop.
You can see they try to run the draw with Taylor right here. They're spreading them out by formation. They like to spread things out horizontally so that they can then go vertical, not only with the passing game, but with the run game. And hopefully by doing that, the linebackers kind of help out by sliding out. That didn't work on that particular play.
Second and 11. Wills, play action. Going deep, has a man downfield, and it's incomplete, just thrown over the head of Tyler Tumpane.
What's kind of interesting about Montini is it really doesn't make any difference if it's first and 10 or it's third and 10. For the most part, that's their game. You can see it's a nice post route right here. The ball, if it's underthrown a little bit more, he's got a catch and he's got six. Montini doesn't look at the sticks too often. There's a good shot at Chris Andriano. He's moved up on all the lists of the most winning coaches in the state of Illinois. He's done a great job for 34 years at Montini.
Third and 11.
Crossing route shallow.
Wills hit as he throws it, and it's incomplete. Borsellino was the intended receiver. It looked like Friend got in there and pretty good lick on Alex Wills.
Kind of an interesting route there. They ran the two outside men deep to take the corners out, and then they ran the two inside slots in what we call shallow crossing routes in front of the linebackers. And that takes a little more time for them to clear, and that's why he got hit just as he threw the football. But he's used to taking some hits, and he's got an interesting offensive line in front of him that averages 235 pounds, which is a pretty good size high school offensive line.
My goodness, they're going to try and kick a field goal from here. It will be,
well, I'll tell you what,
56-yard attempt.
He's kicked one and made it from 51 and 48 this year. Now, he's an all-state kicker, so they're looking at the win. I don't see a lot of win as I look at the flag.
And it looks like a delay of game, maybe.
But he has Andrew Hart, 6'1", 175-pound senior.
Red.
Oh, they called timeout. They waved the flag off.
See, when you
got the timeout just before the clock expired.
That's one of those situations where you can see right there, that's a factor. The coach looks up to the flag, not a lot of win. He asks the kicker, what do you think? He says, coach, give me a shot. Now, keep in mind, Andrew Hart, the kicker, the All-State kicker for Montini, has kicked one from 51 yards out successfully. He's also kicked one from 48 yards out successfully. He is 11 for 13 kicking field goals, with the longest being 51 yards. Strength of his leg, he can kick it deep, but he's also very accurate. He has 53 out of 54 extra points, so he is an excellent kicker. So if I look at him and say, what do you think? And he says, coach, I think I can do it. I'm going to give him a shot.
The record for longest field goal in 5A history is 41 yards, so this would put him in the record books. Andrew Hart, All-Stater. He kicked a last-second field goal against Sycamore, hit the crossbar, and bounced through to give Montini a 24-22 win on the final play of the game.
Boy, that from up here, that does look a long way away. And it is, especially for a high school kicker.
56 yards. Tom Payne on the hole. The kick is up, and it's going to be short.
No, that went about 46.
All right. Well, that was it was worth a shot anyway.
Sure.
All right. Montini takes a 7-0 lead to the break. We're back with more from Champaign right after this. And welcome back to Champaign. A little chilly. Feels like football weather out here today. 7-0 lead for the Montini Broncos over the Morris Redskins. Lee Hall along with IHSA veteran coach Jack McInerney. And now it's the old, what is that, the wing tee?
It is. Well, it's kind of interesting. They went to the old
formation.
Wing team. Yes. I had talked to coach earlier in the week, and he said what happened was the last 2 weeks when they had some weather conditions, they went to this particular formation, which a lot of our fans at home don't remember, but that's the old T formation. And you can do a lot of variety out of it. The only problem is that you keep the defense in relatively tough and tight, and you're relying on your offensive line to produce here. Now, you might have tough, hard running backs, but if the offensive line doesn't produce, that formation is not going to do much for you. But it's been successful in the playoffs for them.
So we'll pick up 3 on first down. This is Grogan with the carry. Let's go downstairs to Matt Rodewald.
You know, guys, when you're talking about preparing for Morris on the offensive side of the football, you have to prepare for multiple formations, whether it's the T formation, the wing T, the pro set, maybe it's a little bit of option. And this isn't just Alan Thorson's deal. This is something that George Durgo had and of course, Dan Darlington had going back 40 years. And, of course, the tradition of power football in Morris still reigns supreme. 35 minutes of time of possession against Sacred Heart Griffin to get the win. That could be the key here today.
Thanks, Matt.
That's a good point, because that's what they want to do.
Give that time is to Jeff Perry, and he has nowhere to go. Yeah, we saw against Washington in overtime, they pulled out everything out of their playbook to get that win. I mean, it was that kind of a ball game against.
Well, again, this is good defense right here by the defense. You can see the penetration by the defensive line right there, but also the linebackers being able to come up and make some tough plays. And that's exactly what happens when you have a constricted offensive formation like that. And, you know, Montini's thrilled if they're going to stay in that particular formation. Again, Montini's going to end up with excellent field position.
Miracle to punt. It's fielded there by Curry.
Oh,
running back and forth. A lot of east-west, not a lot of north-south there from Derek Curry. Here's the one big play so far. It's all it took for Montini to get into the end zone. Dimitri Taylor.
Now, these are things you can't coach right here. Cutbacks like that, open speed, down the field, outrunning the secondary. But just an excellent call early, because Montini figured Morris would think that they're going to be throwing the ball early, so they just ran off tackle and let the Taylor take it to the house, as they say.
That's what the kids say.
I always wonder what that means, take it to the house. Take it to the end zone, I guess.
Strong play to Taylor. He's got a first down and into Morris territory.
See, he really is the X factor, because Morris in their coverage defensively has to account for under coverage on the outside. You can see linebackers dropping out to the outside. They just run him on a draw because the linebackers are forced to help out underneath. There's your draw. The linebackers are gone because they dropped into coverage to help out in the slots. And these are the kind of things that Montini can do just by formation.
Wills at quarterback. He's thrown for over 1,700 yards this year. It pass attempt there tipped at the line of scrimmage. So there's a that's the one thing they always tell the defensive lineman. If you can't get to the quarterback, get your hands up.
There's Frem. Nice job right there. And when you're 6'5", watch him at the top of the screen. Just good athleticism right there. You can just see it was just going to be a little quick curl route to the outside. And at 6'5", you're able to get your hand up. He didn't even have to jump. Nice play. He's headed to Indiana.
Conference Defensive Player of the Year. 2nd and 10 now. Wills with a lot of company in the backfield and a flag and maybe movement too soon for the Broncos that time.
Well, you know, looking at statistics, Montini.
Offense. 5-yard penalty.
See, that doesn't, that particular play does not affect Montini as much as a play like that affected Morris early in the game. But getting back to Montini's offense, they, you know, they average 34 points a game. But they've been given up, which is very unusual for them this year, 20 points a game. So they've been playing it kind of close to the vest. They can always score, but their defense hasn't been as solid as it has been in prior years.
Second and 15, Wills rolls out. Looking right, his receiver falls down. Gorgianis was his intended receiver. He fell as he made his cut at the 30. And it goes incomplete. Now third and 15. Now they can make up the yardage a lot easier than Morris can.
No doubt about it. They've got so many tools and so many excellent wide receivers. It's not as if they have won. Last year, of course, you know, when they won the state championship, they had Westerkamp,
right,
who was just a man amongst boys. He set all kinds of records in the state for receptions, total receptions, yardage, touchdowns by a wide receiver. He set records in the state game last year for most receptions and most yardage. And he's playing in Nebraska right now. But they have more balance this year than they did last year. Most of it last year was just Westerkamp.
Third and 15. Wills back to throw again, looking deep, and overshoots his man. That Gorgianis was looking for a flag, but none thrown. It'll be fourth down. I don't think they'll try an Andrew Hart field goal from.
I don't think so either.
Spot.
It's an interesting call here. He rolls away from Gorgianis here, and he runs a post because he had no help. But the safety reacted very nicely to come back over the top. They were running a flood route to the bottom of the screen and then just running him on a post on the backside. Nice job of reaction by Morris's defense.
Hart is back. He will punt, however, this time. Well, end over ender, bounces and picked up at the 12-yard line by Kyle Hill, and he doesn't go very far with it. Good coverage that time by the Broncos special teams. Punt of 38 yards for Hart.
This is really something that Morris cannot afford to have happen, is to be in such poor field position as they have been so far in this first half. Now, granted, it's only 7-0, but this is exactly what started out in the ball game with them. So we got to, it's kind of interesting. Watch to see what happens on first down. That's so very crucial in this game plan for Morris. See what they do. They've got to pick up 4 to 5 yards to stay within their game plan.
Three and out the last two drives. Sobel with the carry, and he gets maybe 3 or 4 that time.
Now, this is not the kind of offense that people at home like to see when you're looking at a wing tee. It looks like it's an old throwback, but now they have face masks on. But you have to do what's effective for yourself. They want to keep the ball away from Montini. They know the threat that they have. They know the scoring threat from anywhere on the field. But they've got to get a solid drive together.
The only place people my age and younger know the T formation from is the Bears song. Bear Down Chicago. You know that one.
I was tapping my toe to it. This is going to be a big play right here. Oh, looks like a bootleg.
Not much doing there either. Cinnamon picks up about 3.
That, the way that he ran that play, it was tough to tell if he went the wrong way or that was an intended bootleg. It looked like he was kind of not sure. But the wide receiver was blocking backside, so I want to say it was a keep going back to the weak side, but they came up short. So now they're looking at 3rd and 3.
And that is how the first quarter will end. Low scoring, just that one big play to make it a 7-0 Montini lead. Dimitri Taylor's 74-yard touchdown run, the only scoring after 12 minutes.
Welcome back to Memorial Stadium, where the Montini Broncos lead 7-0 here. The Aurora Christian Eagles sit behind me, the Class 3A champions. They are here in support of Montini. They were part of a fundraising effort for Johnny Weiger, a sophomore football player for Montini, who lost his battle with leukemia during the quarterfinals. Aurora Christian and Montini, of course, conference mates, and Aurora Christian helped raise nearly $8,000 for the Johnny Weiger Medical Fund. Montini Broncos are wearing 76 helmet decals. His parents Fran and Carl are standing on the sidelines in support of Johnny's teammates. Lee?
Thank you, Sophia. It's a cold day in Champaign, but that story just gives you chills. There's Don Beebe, and what a great effort on behalf of Johnny Weiger and his family as we get back to action here. Cinnamon met and brought down at the line of scrimmage. James Maloney. We talked to Chris Andriano about Johnny Weiger earlier this week, Jack, and he said he was a great kid. All of our kids loved him. Played inspired football that week that he died, and he was definitely on their minds. And what a great, the cooperation and the great, you saw Don Beebe before the game with Johnny Weiger's parents on the sideline. It just, it's everything that's good about high school athletics.
Well, that's very true, and it's amazing that two schools that are such rivals can come together for a common cause like that, and such a wonderful cause it is. And it also brings their communities together, but more than that, it brings the two teams and the young men together to realize there's more to it than
right.
The game of football.
Absolutely. And the Montini players were here last night for the Aurora Christian game. Just it's a tragic story, loss of a young man, but what came out of it is very inspiring.
Well, Morris certainly has their hands full here, Lee. Again, Montini could never, if they had their wish list last night, they could never have guessed that they could get such great field position throughout this game.
Miracle's punt stops at the 43 and bounces backward. There's a flag down at the 35-yard line.
Well, here's what Morris has to contend with here in the second quarter. This is Montini's big scoring quarter. They average over 11 points a game in the second quarter. Now that doesn't sound like a lot of points, but when you're talking about in 13 previous games, it comes with a lot of points as you spread it out throughout a ball game. So this is their big scoring quarter for them throughout the season. And again, the field position is just amazing. And what's amazing about it is it's looking at the scoreboard. It's only 7-0 because they've had three possessions, possibly four, where they've had the ball at midfield.
A lot of discussion going on here. It appears the penalty is against Montini.
During the play, holding 34 on the receiving team. 10-yard penalty for the spot.
And that's a really unfortunate penalty because nobody picked up the ball. I mean, it was just bouncing around loose. There was nobody going to return that.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see what Morris does here in the second quarter now. Their defense has been part of their strength. They only have given up in 13 games prior to this. 12 points a game is their average, and that's pretty darn good when their offense has been scoring 35.
Alex Wills at quarterback, hands off to Taylor. He's got room to run outside the 50. Now down to about the 38-yard line. Pickup of 14, and he's got a first down. Taylor now with 88 yards on the day.
Well,
74 on one play.
Well, in my comment before, I mean, he's just got the speed to get outside, something that Morris does not have right now. And you can see the job that's done by his wide receivers. This is part of being a wide receiver at Montini. You've got to be able to block. And that's exactly what they do downfield. They not only catch the football, but they block for their running backs.
Joe Borsellino doing a good job with the blocking that time. Now it's Gorgianis at quarterback. He hands it off. Taylor again, but not much doing that time. Pickup of a couple.
You know, we're talking about offenses and defense, and looking at the schedule that Morris played through this year, I don't think they really played against the team that had the versatility and the type of athletes that Montini has. Granted, they had a tough schedule, but Montini is a very unique football team in so much as they have such great talent, and they played big, tough schedule early on. Their first two ball games. Their second game that they lost was against Lincoln Way East, who is playing in the 7A state championship today, sitting at 13-0.
Gorgianis handles a high snap, takes it himself, flag on the play. After a pickup of a couple. Well, then the question is there another team in Illinois that you would face that would be similar to Montini to even prepare you for something like
well,
this?
Well, you know, it's interesting you asked that question, and this was not prepared.
On the offense,
But Lincoln Way East, who's going to play in the 7A state championship game, has a very similar offense to Montini. As our folks this afternoon will see, they have a great quarterback. They run the same kind of offense that Montini runs, but they don't throw it as much. They have a, their quarterback is more of a runner. He's run for about 1,200 some yards, but very interesting. They both played against each other. A lot of similarities. Good shot there of Chris Andriano, who has coached with the times. 34 years there. He would never have thought his first 15 or 20 years that he'd be running the spread in his 34th year.
There you get a look at the field position, and definitely in favor of Montini as Borsellino throws to Gorgianis and gets much of that yardage back on that penalty.
Again, just one of their good plays. They just run a little bubble screen on the outside, and the key to that is the downfield blocking by the wide receivers. You got to spend a lot of time doing this. You can see right here, he just turns, the guard pulls, gets out in front, just a spot pass. He gets on somebody. Everybody's locked on somebody.
And here's our first look at the Joe Cat offense, as they call it. It's that Wildcat offense, and they call it the Joe Cat for Joe Borsellino. Even the teachers at Montini call him Joe Cat now.
It's amazing how schools and communities can get caught up in very successful football programs, especially in the fall. You know, when football is really the gathering point for the school and the community early.
Fourth and three. Wills throws it outside to Gorgianis. He has the first down inside the 25, down to the 24-yard line. Pickup of six, and it's first down and 10, Montini.
Great block right at the point of attack right there. And that's all timing, because you can't go out and make the block too early. You can see the step and the block right there. Excellent timing to pick up that first down. There's a lot of time spent in the summertime working on the timing of these plays that are coming up in November. You think back in June and July when they were running these in shorts in 7-on-7 leagues around the state, and now all of a sudden Thanksgiving weekend they're running the same plays here.
Joe Borsellino again on the block. He making some key contributions with his blocking. 7-0 our score. Montini leading Morris. Let's go downstairs to Sophia Minert.
Lee, of course, Andriano gave a lot of credit to his offensive coordinator, Luis Borsellino, just saying it's not an easy job to get all the parts in that we have and at what times, saying Borsellino has essentially developed an offensive package for each kid, each position player, gave him a lot of credit for having a pulse of what makes this offense go.
Yeah, those assistant coaches, the unsung heroes, Luis Borsellino, the offensive coordinator. There is his son Joe, the last of the Borsellinos, until the grandkids anyway.
Well, I was going to say that, you know, that tree's a long tree with a lot of branches out there. This is a little reverse coming back out of the slot. You can see here the guard pulling, good blocking at the point of attack, good tackle coming from the backside, and it could have been a big play, and it turned out to be a short yardage, 3-yarder.
Nick Countryman with the stop there for Morris. Will's looking to throw a flag before they could get the play started.
These are the type of things in state championship games you don't want to have happen. Penalties.
Dead ball foul. Snap infraction. On red. 5-yard penalty. Replay the down.
That's very, very unusual for Montini, who's so very well versed in their offense. And you can see Chris Andriano there not real happy about that.
Both teams, the penalties are keeping them out of a rhythm offensively.
Oh, there's no doubt about it. And it's really unusual because they're such good football teams and so very well coached.
Second and 12.
Spreading the field, wide side trip set, and they're going to single coverage up top. And I think that's where they might want to go.
Alex Wills, he's their throwing quarterback.
Oh,
and he gets sacked. One arm pull down by Colin Grogan.
What a big play by Grogan. And he's also, for a defensive back, I mean, he's playing nose. He's only 5'9", 205, but he just beats the center, and he's right there. That's a big play.
Wow.
Because at the top of the screen, he was open on a deep route. So Grogan, Colin Grogan there, that was a great play right there. That was a big sack.
Loss of 7.
Sometimes people look and wonder, why is there a running back's number up front of the defensive line? Because they want a quick defender up there.
Third and 19. Wills. It's Gorgianis, first down at the 12-yard line. Pick up of 21.
Boy, he put that ball right on the money off of that sprint out. And the reason they ran that sprint out was because they were getting pressure and they wanted to get out on the edge a little bit to get away from that pressure. But look at the delivery of the football right here. Nice catch and nice throw. You can see the defender backing off real quickly, but he knows where the first down marker is. Good catch. Defender tried to rip through the football, but wasn't able to get it.
Now it's Borsellino at quarterback, handing off to Taylor, and not much doing that time. This team, Montini, averages 200 yards rushing a game, 170 yards passing. So pretty balanced. And rushing, I mean, you would think that the numbers would skew in a spread team to very heavily pass oriented, but they rush the ball a lot.
They really do. And the other part of this, a lot of times they play the short pass. They don't go deep all the time like these passes right here.
Borsellino, the catch, well defended by Morris.
Those are runs to Morris, and that's what Montini does. They run the short outs, the quick screens like that, and that's why, you know, the balance is so good there, because they don't really go for the big bomb all the time, as most people would think when you're looking at the passing team with the passing formations. Now later on today we'll see that in the 6A game, probably with Crete Moni. You're going to see one of the top receiver in the country, and he can flat out fly. And that's a team that'll really air it out going deep.
Montini calls timeout here as you get a look at Alan Thorson, Morris head coach. Seven nothing our score here as we are midway through the second quarter. Jack McInerney, both offenses stalling a little bit because of penalties, and not, you know, we saw that first play, that opening play from Montini. We thought, well, boy, here we go. But Morris has done a nice job defensively keeping them out of the end zone.
Well, it really has. And what's happened is they both hurt themselves by their penalties, and they've done it early in first down and second down to put themselves in third and long, something Montini's used to, but certainly something Morris is not used to.
Morris, you have to defend against so many things when you're playing Montini. I mean, it's the pass, it's the run, it's, you know,
great
the
balance.
Different formations that
as
they're
you mentioned,
finding
they,
a way.
They really do have great balance, and that's so very difficult to defend. And Morris isn't loaded with a ton of speedsters down there. So they've got to change up coverages and make the reads more difficult for Montini and hope they throw him off that way.
Third and eight. It's Wills at quarterback this time. And another whistle and another flag.
This is really amazing. And the thing that's so very difficult is for coaches.
Ball start on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Coaches really have a tough time with these particular penalties. You can live with a penalty if it occurs during a play. Okay, the kids are being aggressive, they hold, or maybe they clip, something along those lines. But when there's a penalty before the play is ever run, that's one of the most difficult things for coaches to comprehend.
Fifth penalty on Montini. Third down now, as they're in four down territory, you would imagine. The throw to the end zone is caught, but out of bounds. That's Michael Dusick. He was out of bounds when he caught it, and it'll bring up fourth down.
Ran a little combination route down here. He ended up with the real wheel route. They ran the wide guy in a post, and then the slot man ran the wheel in behind him, and he would have been out of bounds either way. You got to give him more room to catch the ball in bounds. But now we're going to look at Andrew Hart, well within his range as far as field goals are concerned. In fact, this is just a chip shot for him.
And we'll go ahead and try and take the 3 points here. 32-yard attempt. It's up.
Oh!
No good.
Oh!
Wide left.
That really is amazing. Now, he certainly had enough leg there.
He was taking another look at it.
Well, that's a little disheartening for him. A long one. He came up short, and then a short one, he came up wide. Let's take a look from this angle, because from we're right up here.
Ooh.
know.
Yeah. He certainly doesn't agree. Morris is very happy about it.
Redskins first and 10, and it's Sobel with the carry, pickup of about 7.
Now see, that's exactly what they need. Now maybe that was the incentive, maybe that was what they needed. You saw the crowd down here, you heard the crowd down here with Morris kind of give a roll, a big scream after that missed field goal, and now you get a nice run on first down, and this is what they do. This kind of maybe changed the momentum a little bit for him.
Sobel averages a little over 8 yards per carry. That was a 12-play, 5.5-minute drive for Montini, and they come up empty. Second and 3, the gives to Perry. He loses it. Fumble.
This is really disastrous. Disastrous. Oh, they got it back. When he first got that ball, I looked down and I thought he was getting a fake because he looked so casual with it. And obviously, he was casual with it. Just giving the fullback on a short dive. Nice job by the offensive line right there, but he was just carrying the ball low. He didn't have a good grip on the football coming out. Great camera shot right there. Just got a little bump, put the ball on the ground, and that shouldn't happen with a fullback. Now, granted, he doesn't carry the ball all that often, but that was a big first down for him.
Looked like one of the Montini linemen might have got a hand on it.
But now this is kind of what Morris likes to do. First down. That's the crucial part for them. What are they going to do on first down? Play action.
Cinnamon looking left and overthrows Perry, his intended receiver.
He actually had the tight end dragging across who was open rather than the back coming out of the backfield. But see, you want to keep him off balance. I can understand that. But now that puts them in a different situation. I might have tried that on second down if I would have had second and third or fourth. But now you're looking at second and 10. You might dig yourself a little hole here.
Cinnamon, a pretty accurate thrower. He hasn't thrown it a lot, but he was 50 of 81 passing coming into this ball game, 883 yards.
Well, doing the math in my head real quick, in a matter of 13 games, that's only 6 times he throws the ball per game. So that's not a lot of passing. Oh, good blocks.
Sobel tries to get outside. Montini strings it out. Joshua Belt with the takedown at about the 31-yard line.
And this is what we're talking about, Lee. You can see right here. Really doesn't have the speed to get out to that edge. And, of course, right there, the corner's on blocked. They just had one extra man with the safety coming up. But Morris cannot afford this. Now they're looking at 3rd and 9. This is really a no-no for Morris's offense. So that first down play was so very crucial, that incomplete pass. It can come back to haunt you. You got to pick your spots.
Chris Andriano said to us earlier this week, we've got to bring our best game physically. And he asked the question, which defense will rise to the occasion? It is a defensive struggle right here in the latter stages of the second quarter. Cinnamon rolling left. The left-hander throws it way over the intended receiver. Now, Jake Hogan was the guy that he was looking for. He was double covered, and it was way over his head.
It really was. He overthrew him, and yet he still had a man wide open in the corner. And right here, he's just rolling out to get away from the pressure, and he just overthrows him. But he actually had, you can see right there, right, the man on the left hand of the screen right there is wide open. There was nobody around him. But you got to understand, he only throws the ball on an average 6 times a game. Now, granted, he completes 3 of those, but you know, he's not used to throwing the ball. He's already thrown more today than he does normally. And this, we're not even done with the first half.
Miracle to punt. He's been busy today. Caught, dropped, and picked back up by Curry. And then dropped in his tracks. He dropped the ball and was dropped in his tracks. 32-yard punt for Miracle. His 4th punt of the day. Montini ball when we come back.
Back here at Memorial Stadium, a 7-0 lead for Montini and the Broncos here in our Class 5A state championship. We have a lot coming up for you at halftime. We'll have conversations with Montini head coach Chris Andriano and Morris head coach Alan Thorson, and also a special conversation with Sycamore All-Stater Ben Neiman. He's the wide receiver, the senior, who happened to play Morris and Montini the last couple of years. So Lee and Jackie will have an interesting perspective having watched the first half of this game.
All right, Matt, thank you very much. I don't envy him having to face these two teams, but we look forward to hearing what he has to say. 4:34 to go here, second quarter. Montini, first and 10. Here's Taylor trying to get to the outside.
Nice
and
job.
Morris does a nice job of stretching that one out. Perry, the All-Stater, making contact at the end, sideline there.
Just a straight jet sweep right out of here with the motion man going to the top of the screen where they actually had three wide receivers blocking, but it doesn't look like they blocked anybody, and just a little love tap right there at the end.
They give him one. Gorgianis now, quarterback draw. He picks up about 7 yards, be a couple of yards shy of the first down.
It's nice to have an athlete like this that can run. You can insert back there, just a quarterback draw. They spread him out. Linebacker stays home. He's kind of mirroring him, but a nice block right there to take him out of the play. But he picks up 9. Now it puts him in a reasonable position at 3rd and 2. And running that draw was a nice play by Georgianis.
Go back to Alex Wills, the transfer from Wheaton South at quarterback. Or no, that's Joe. No, that is Gorgianis. Excuse me. He keeps it and takes it for the first down. Pick up a 4 into Morris territory. Need to get those guys some numbers on their shoulder like the NFL so we can tell who's who back there.
There you go. And those numbers are relatively small, but you can see right here just a nice job. They know the personnel packages they have in for the down and distances, and they're accomplishing what they started out to do with those particular packages. Now they're spreading them out again with a little pistol look here.
Gorgianis still at QB, throws it out to the near side, and a flag on that play after the completion to Michael Dusick.
Gorgianis's pass is complete.
Dusick is one of those receivers in Montini's arsenal that has really been unheralded most of the season, because you hear about Taylor and you hear about Borsellino and Gorgianis, but you haven't heard a lot about Dusick, and he's had 35 catches for 344 yards. He's a speedster.
Offense.
Gives him some nice balance on the edges, but right there we had a
10-yard penalty for the spotter foul. Replay, third down.
Sixth penalty against Montini, 48 yards in penalties for Chris Andriano's team.
You know, you talk about those at halftime, he'll look at the stats and see, you know, in certain situations we had these penalties that took us out of good field position, put us in real bad field position. But oftentimes you can talk about penalties at halftime, but it's not something you can go on the blackboard with to fix. That's right. More of a mental adjustment that has to be made in the locker room.
Mistakes we're not used to seeing from the Montini program. First and 21. Wills now at quarterback. Montini will look to put the ball in the air, and Krogan got a hand on it. Incomplete pass.
What a great play right there. He read that the whole way coming up.
Colin Grogan, 5'9", 205-pound senior, makes a great athletic play here.
Watch this. It's just a screen, a dump out here, and we just kind of miss it right there. But he makes the tip. I think we'll catch it here. He gets out in front, and what he does is he reads the lineman. And then he keys to the back. Where's the back? Knowing that the lineman can't catch it, but the lineman is pulling for a reason. What a great defensive play that was right there.
Morris defense stepping up here, only allowing 12 and a half points per game this season. Second and 21. Wills all alone in the backfield, rolling right, looking for a man. Can't find anybody, now does. That's Gorgianis.
Good stop. That was a good defensive job by Morris. They put pressure on the quarterback to keep him running, not allow him to set his feet to look downfield. But the secondary did an excellent job because they kept all the receivers in front of them, knowing that they didn't want anybody to get deep. This puts pressure on the secondary whenever you get a quarterback rolling like that, because they lose sight of their receivers. But nice job right here. He didn't pick, came up short. He's about 10 yards short of the first down, and that was a good job by the secondary keeping the receivers in front of him.
10-yard pickup, 3rd and 11. Look at Gorgianis. 459 yards rushing, 341 passing, 541 receiving. He does it all for this Montini team. Wills looking to throw, has Taylor. He's got it at the 25, now the 20, inside the 10.
Oh, wow.
Spin move at the 10.
Oh.
Still on his feet. Touchdown, D'Amico. Marjorie Taylor.
What a play.
48 yards on the pitch and catch from Wills to Dimitri Taylor. And what a game this young man is having.
Now tomorrow when you read the stats in the newspaper, you'll read 46 yard touchdown pass. That's not what it was. It was about a 20 yard throw and then a tremendous run after the catch. Take a look at the catch. Good catch and throw, but now here's where they start talking about it. Great spin out right here and just an excellent job of wanting to get into that end zone. Great job by Taylor.
Taylor, a touchdown run, a touchdown reception. Hart's extra point blocked.
And that could be a big play. Doesn't seem like much right now, but down the road it could be a big play.
Only one missed extra point all year for Hart coming in.
This is really a touch pass right here, right over the top. He gets past the linebacker in the middle field, and then after that, it's yardage after the catch. And those are the kind of things you can't account for. You can account for the throw, you know, if you're throwing a 12-yard out or a 10-yard out. But on plays like this, you never know what's going to happen after the catch. And when you got the ball in the hands of Dimitri Taylor, that's kind of the result of it.
Great body control, the spin, the stepping over, the would-be tackler inside the five, Dimitri Taylor, his 14th touchdown of the year.
Now that's a good shot right there of Wills, a quarterback, and I don't think that we should diminish what an excellent throw that was, because that was really a touch pass, just dropping over the top of the linebacker and in between the safeties.
Well, Alex Wills with the completion,
right,
and Dimitri Taylor making him look pretty good with that yak, the yards after catch.
Well, you know, the game has not been the kind of game that I thought it would be from the standpoint of it's been sloppy with penalties. And that's kind of changed the scoreboard look, and certainly has changed for Morris in this first half. So far they've had terrible field position throughout much of the ball game, and Montini's been very fortunate with field position. So you could look at a couple of things: field position and penalties resulting in why the score is what it is.
Hart the kickoff and the return by Jason Madison, flagged on the play, comes in late. Madison's out of bounds at about the 17 yard line. The flag, those are normally against the receiving team.
Well, when I look down at Morris catching the kickoffs
on the receiving team,
I don't see threats as I see with Taylor and some of the other players on Montini. Montini just has really good overall team speed, and Morris just lacks that breakaway runner, whether it be on special teams or coming out of the backfield. They're just a team that's very strong up front and very physical. There's my X factor. He certainly has come into play. I need to buy a lottery ticket. Boy, he is one heck of a football player. And really, he's had a very steady year all year long. But what a time to shine in a state championship
game.
And
that was just his rushing number. You can add that 48-yard touchdown catch to the 103 yards rushing. Sobel picks up about four.
A little crossbuck look out of the T formation, fake to the fullback, and then give to the back, coming back across the backfield off tackle. Picks up about four or five. That's what they need to do. But right now, with a minute and 50 left, they don't want to give up the football here. They need to go into halftime and make some adjustments on the blackboard.
Inside 2 minutes now for the first half.
Now I fell right into the trap of the T formation, saying go in and make adjustments on the blackboard. I should have said the dry erase board.
Here's Perry with it. He takes it out near the 20-yard line, and a flag comes in late.
Been a lot of flags.
They might even do it on an iPad, Coach. I don't know.
Please, now you're really getting over my head. I think we're going to see a completely different second half, though. I think they're going to tighten a lot of things up.
5 yard face pass on the defense.
And one of the things that needs to be tightened up, and I'm not positive how they can do that, is Morris's field position. They've got to sustain some drives so that if they do have to punt, they'll force Montini into their own field position to start driving, where then, in fact, if they were to stop Montini, Montini gives up the ball to them in midfield. So it's kind of a chess match back and forth.
First and 10 for the Redskins from their own 25. Sobel, ooh, here's a good carry for him. He's got a first down. pickup of 13. Let's go downstairs quickly to Sophia Minner.
Lee, you might want to take another look at that touchdown. Dimitri Taylor is sitting on the Montini bench. He's taken off his right cleat. He's trying to work it out, trying to move it around. I don't know if he rolled the ankle going in for the end zone, but he's just trying to work out some stiffness right now, I think.
And he's leading the band, it appears. I don't think he's hurt too seriously.
Good job there, penetration. Excellent job by Preston Miracle, 240-pound nose man. Just did a nice swim move on the guard and had good penetration. Morse cannot afford to have penetration by Montini. Is that Dylan Thompson on that particular play? Good penetration for a big man.
Under a minute to go now. 13-0 Montini. Dimitri Taylor, a long touchdown run, a long touchdown reception that was most of it on his own accord.
Screen.
Here comes the rush. Friend, the catch. Cinnamon get hit after he let go of it?
A little bit. He got a lot of pressure again from number 59, Dylan Thompson, who made that play previously. And for a big man, it's 6'6", 260. And he's only a junior. He can really move. Good pass rush, and then he gets out on the edge. So Dylan Thompson has got a lot to showcase here as only a junior. Very impressive.
Last play of the half. Cinnamon from the shotgun.
He's open.
Looking deep. Nice leaping grab there by Perry. And that's how the first half will end. Yeah, maybe something to build on there for Morris. If they can do that, then maybe they come out of the wing tee.
They need to do that, but they need to do it in a more selective fashion than they're doing it thus far.
13-0 our score at halftime. Sophia Minner's downstairs.
Coach Andriano, you said you wanted to win the big play department, and two big plays have given you a 13-0 lead here.
Yeah, that was nice. DT, of course, has got that kind of ability, but we wasted a few opportunities as well. So, you know, we got a few adjustments to make at halftime.
Tremendous field position for you throughout the first half. Disappointing at all to come away with only 13?
Yeah, I think it is. And we think we really should be a little bit upset with ourselves that we didn't come up with more points. We missed two field goals. We had more opportunities for points, and you can't let a good team hang around.
All right, thank you, Coach Lee. Back up to you.
All right, Sophia, one of the all-time greats there. Chris Andriano trying to win his fourth straight state championship with the Montini Broncos. Dimitri Taylor doing a lot to help him out. Two touchdowns for him, 13-0, the Montini lead at halftime.
And we welcome you back to Memorial Stadium. Our score at the break, Montini, the Broncos with a 13-0 lead on the Redskins here in our Class 5A state championship game. Matt Rodewald with here. I'm joined by Sycamore All-State receiver Ben Neiman, the junior, who had a chance to play Morris and Montini, so he's got an interesting perspective on how you got to face them throughout the year. So tell me what you've seen in the first half between these two teams. Who has the advantage? It looks like Montini with the big plays.
Yeah, Montini's on top right now. They've just controlled things throughout the whole game. Morris hasn't really been able to get anything going offensively. They've just been trying to pound the ball. They've gone to like the wing tee, and they're just doing different things, trying to keep the ball away from Montini. And then Montini had a first good drive. Dimitri Taylor had a long run, and then they kind of stalled out for a little while. And then Dimitri Taylor again had a good catch and run to score. So he's kind of been carrying the Broncos so far this half.
You guys had some success against Montini in their quarterfinal game, trying to swing it out to the sides and kind of stretching them out. Morris doesn't really do that. Is that something that you think they could do? Do they have enough speed to do that?
Yeah, when we played Montini, we ran some screens and different things and spread them out, and then we'd run the ball and just try to like do different things to get our offense going, and it worked, especially in the second half. But Morris is just kind of like a smash mouth team. They don't really throw the ball too much. But yeah, I think that could work if they decide to go to that the second half.
If you're Montini, you'd expect adjustments from Morris defensively in the second half. What is it that you see when you're playing a Morris defense that you have to prepare for defensively?
Morris?
As far as what you see on the Morris defensive side?
Yeah, they're tough. They're really physical. You know, and it's tough to run the ball against them too. But Montini's done a good job just throwing a lot of different things at him. So
It's got to be a unique perspective just for you to see these two teams out here and having gone back and forth. How do you think this is going to shake down here in the second half?
Yeah, it's interesting because we played them both. It's kind of just strange watching, you know, because we played them both this year. So, but, I mean, if Montini keeps doing what they're doing and Morris doesn't make adjustments, I mean, it's tough to come back, especially against a team like Montini. But both teams are well coached and they have a lot of talent on both sides. So it'll be an interesting second half.
Ben Neiman, the junior All-Stater, maybe we'll see you down here next year.
I hope so. That'd be great.
All right, the Spartan All-Stater, congratulations to him on a big All-State award. Montini and Morris, the spin move, the nifty move, the X-Factor. Dimitri Taylor finding the end zone twice. The Broncos on top.
And welcome back to Memorial Stadium on the campus of the University of Illinois in Champaign-Urbana. Lee Hall, Jack McInerney, Montini leading 13-0 over Morris here at the half. And we crowned four state champions yesterday. Moroa Forsyth, Mercer County over Belleville Altoff, 14-7. It was Aurora Christian winning their second straight state title. Rochester winning their third straight. Montini going for their fourth in a row here this afternoon. 13-0 the score here at halftime. Coming up next on the IHSA TV network, Cary Grove and Crete Moni, a couple of number one seeds. Two teams, two different philosophies offensively. Looking forward to that game. One of the top receivers in the country for Crete Moni in that ball game. Then at 4 o'clock, it's Glenbard West taking on Lincoln Way East, one of only two teams all year to beat the Montini Broncos. And then in 8A, it's Glenbard North against the storied Mount Carmel Caravan, coached by Frank Lenti, making his 14th state finals appearance, and that is a state record. Lee Hall, Jack McInerney, we take a look at that first half, and penalties a big part of the story.
Really is. Two teams that are not playing as well as they normally have played throughout the year. Those penalties have wreaked havoc and field position for both teams. They got in situations where it looked like they might have an opportunity to score, and they get backed off, and then the plays don't go according to plan. So they need to make some adjustments in that first half, because it's going to be very interesting to see what adjustments are made for this cup upcoming second half.
Shea Sobel has some pretty good individual yards, but Morris really not able to get a drive going offensively.
Well, I don't think that they're going to be able to stay in that wing T look. I mean, it's power football, but what happens then is you pack everybody in. You got a 10-man front to block,
right,
and they don't have the speed that even if they do break one, they're still going to get up, be run down. I think they have to go back to that pro I that they ran in that first quarter to have any chance against Montini. But field position will be a big factor for Morris.
And Montini, a team with a very versatile offense, but the guy that's hitting pay dirt is Dimitri Taylor. Here he is, first play of the game.
Well, this is just an amazing athlete right here. And you talk about vision and quickness, and you'll just be able to turn it on and outrun. You can see the difference between his kind of speed and Sobel when he made his breakaway in that first series for Morris. And then, of course, he shows his versatility just sliding out of the backfield. Nice touch pass by Wills over the top behind the linebacker. And then he turns his athleticism on, does his spin, cut back into the end zone, 6 points. And that's Dimitri Taylor, two touchdowns. He's the X Factor for Montini.
Here's our Comcast Business Class first half statistics. Take a look at the rushing yards. Like I said, Morris over 100 yards rushing, but really no drive, no sustainable drive, and the passing yards, of course, as you would expect, in Montini's favor.
Aside from those passing yards, it's not all that dramatically different,
right,
aside from the scoreboard. Sometimes it has to do with where the flag is coming from.
Right, and that those flags have stalled Morris in such a way, as you thought. I thought you mentioned so eloquently earlier in the game, putting them in positions on second and third down where they're not used to being, and where they're really, their offense can't be effective in those long yardage situations on second and third down.
They really can't. First down is so very crucial for Morris, no doubt about it. Montini's just the opposite. First down is the same as third down for them. Morris is not that kind of offense, nor do they have the same kind of athletes that Montini has to be able to handle situations like that.
And if you're the the Morris coaching staff, you look at your defense, and other than those two big plays by Taylor, really you've done a pretty decent job.
You really have. You can't allow a back like that to get out past the linebackers, because when he's in the open field, that puts all your secondary on an island, and you're not going to catch him one-on-one or make that tackle.
Boy, he made some amazing moves on that pass catch, and he gives Montini a 13-0 lead here at halftime as Montini goes for a fourth straight state championship here in our 5A state title game. I don't know how to say his name. We are back. Do a little Gangnam Style. Are you hip to that, Jack?
I've done that.
On purpose?
Yes.
Or when you were slipping on the ice. 13-0 Montini leading Morris in our 5A state championship. Let's take a look at yesterday's action. 1A, it was Maroa Forsyth in 1A for the first time since the 80s, and sophomore Jack Hockaday leading the way for the Trojans. What an afternoon he had. Maroa, a 20-0 lead. Stockton came back with 24 third quarter points, but Hockaday made the big plays in the fourth quarter as Maroa Forsyth picks up their second state championship. The first state championship, his brother Luke was the quarterback. In 2A, it was Mercer County taking on Belleville Althoff. Questionable call here. Was he down? Was he not? Jackson not whistled down. Devin Morford, number 35 for Mercer County, picked it up and took it 95 yards. That was the big play of the day in a 14-7 Mercer County win. 14-7, quite a close game there in Class 3A. Aurora Christian going for their second straight state title. And it's Joel Boganon with the big run here for the Eagles. Don Beebe's team winning their second straight state championship. And what a job Coach Beebe has done with the program. Boganon, 6'2 senior. Great job running for the Eagles last night. And in 4A, it was Rochester winning their third straight state championship under Coach Leonard. Nice little pitch and catch here for the Rockets. And their quarterback, Austin Green, number 14, the 6'2 senior, leading Derek Leonard's team to their third straight state championship. Exciting IHSA football here yesterday in Champaign, and here's a look at what we've got coming up the rest of the day. We've got Montini and Morris squaring off right here. Cary Grove and Crete Moni for the 6A state title is our second game of the day. Coming up at 4 o'clock, it's Glenbard West against Lincoln Way East. And then the nightcap of two straight days of football, Glenbard North taking on Mount Carmel. Let's go downstairs to Matt Rodewald.
Alan Thorson, what'd you guys talk about at halftime?
No, just I think we came out with a little jitters there in the first half, but we saw some good things too. We just need to settle down and start playing Redskin football like we've done all year, and if we can do that, I think we're going to make a better second half of this.
Big plays from Dimitri Taylor. How do you adjust to that in the second half?
You know, we knew that coming in. That's obviously a very good team over there, and they're a big play offense. So we need to just get a little more sound on defense, and our offense needs to settle down. And again, if we can do that, I'm confident in our boys.
This is a time where you can rely on Zach Cinnamon's arm just a little bit more.
Yeah, you know what? I mean, we need our playmakers to step up. Zach's one of them. He's led us all year, and you know, we need, like I said, the O-line. We got to get a little better protection. We need the guys to step up, but after that, I think we're gonna be all right.
Okay, Coach, good luck in the second half.
Thanks a lot.
Head Coach Alan Thorson. Guys, send it up to you.
All right, Matt Rodewald, thank you very much. Morris trying to get back in this ball game. Nothing to show for their efforts so far on the scoreboard. It's Montini, the 13-0 lead as we get ready to kick off the third quarter. Don't have that wind. We are back. Montini fans with a lot to cheer about in that first half. 13-0, the Broncos leading Morris. Chris Andriano going for his fourth straight state title as head coach, trying to join the likes of Mount Carmel's Frank Lenti, New Lenox Providence's Matt Sefner, Driscoll's Tim Racky, and JCA's Gordy Gillespie, each with four straight state titles. Racky's Driscoll Catholic team won seven straight state titles. That's still hard to imagine.
Well,
even though I was here for all of them.
And they broke them up. They literally broke them up. The school closed.
Right.
So that's one way of breaking up a dynasty. But, you know, getting back to the four-peat here for Chris Andriano, when they break the huddle on everything they do, the term they use is four-peat.
Right.
You've seen the kids put their hands together in a huddle and, you know, ready, and then they go four-peat. And so it's something that's been in their mind, on their mind, the entire year. So it's one of their mottos that they have. They have a couple of them, but that's one of the major mottos they've had coming into this year. And that's quite a motto to have when you've already put three state champions in your pocket. Now you're looking for your fourth.
Well, and that's what Chris Andriano said too, is the kids are into making history. We haven't shied away from it. You know, there's no use of pretending it's not there. A short little kick here and a fair catch called for by Montini. James Maloney was one of the up guys. He called for the fair catch very quickly after that kick was made, and it'll be first and 10 from the 30 for Montini with a 13-0 lead. So a pretty decent field position to start the third quarter.
Well, they've had decent field position throughout the first half, but again, Morris is going to be relying on their defense. Their defense has been good for them all year long. They've only given up 12 points a game. Granted, they're over that average right now, but if they can shut them out in the second half, we've got a ball game.
Picked off. Danny Friend got a hand on the pass from Alex Wills, and he had nothing but wide open spaces between him and the end zone.
Oh, 2 weeks ago he picked one off just like this and ran it in from 24 yards at 6'5". He's a guy that can go up and get it. What he does is he gets in between the outside linebacker there and the inside receiver. Oh, that would have been a big pick, and he could have just trotted in from the end zone there into the end zone. Ooh, would that been a change?
Yes, sir. Second and 10.
I think for a tight end, he might have caught that.
Wills flushed out of the pocket. Friend on his tail. Rolling right. Tries to get it to Gorgianis, and it's incomplete.
Well, that's interesting right now. I would love to have been. This is part of the coach that's still in me here, being in that locker room, and either one of those locker rooms be a fly on a wall and just listen to what they were talking about, you know, in Montini's locker room and Morris's locker room, what changes they had to make. And I shouldn't say changes. I should say adjustments, because these teams got here by running solid offenses and solid defenses. So they're at the point right now where they're making adjustments at halftime. They're not making changes.
Third and 10. Opening drive of the third quarter. Alex Wills all by his lonesome throws it out to Taylor. He makes a move at the 35. He's got a first down. And he's out to the 44-yard line. Pickup of 14.
Just a regular back would have caught that and came up about 3 yards short of that first down. But the moves that he made after the catch, just prior to picking up that first down. Right here, not bad. Right there, holes there. But here's the moves right here that pick up the first down. The cutback right there. And that's the extra 2 yards he needed to get that first down. That was a big play by Taylor, and he's been thus far a player of big plays.
Had 7 catches and a touchdown in last year's state title game.
Here he is
again. A just easy running motion for Dimitri Taylor. Makes it look so easy. Down to the 38-yard line. Pickup of 18.
That was nothing fancy, just a draw coming back this way. You can see the guard and tackle. It's just a counter. The guard pulls and the tackle pulls.
Look at him glide.
And he's just waiting for that second gear to kick in for that block downfield. He gets David Sarkin, 66 and 53 Ferraro, out in front of him on the little counter. And then all of a sudden he's looking for a block. But the cutback's the key. And he's just a tough player to bring down in the open field.
Here's the Joe Cat. Joe Borsellino takes it down inside the 30. He's close to a first down.
And that's just nothing more than an option play. He's reading the backside linebacker to see where he goes on the fake. Watch him read. He closed down. He keeps the ball and goes where that linebacker should have been. If that defensive end or outside linebacker closes down in the initial fake, then he's going to keep the ball and go outside of him. So their three-headed monster has been very active here now. Now they've got Wills back in at quarterback.
Very impressive just how seamless they are. It just does, I mean, you don't even notice that they're changing quarterbacks. It's just one guy moves in, one guy moves out. Wills, pump fake. Throws for Gorgianis. Gorgianis stopped.
Well, there was a pump fake to that off of that, Lee, the quarterback made, but the defender never bit on it one bit. He backpedaled and stayed in his backpedal. He did not come up. He was playing a soft corner, and that's what threw that playoff.
Here's a look at Dimitri Taylor. Chris Andriano, you can't give him any higher praise than this, says he's a complete player. And we've seen him do a little bit of everything. Catch, run. He hasn't played quarterback, but he's one of the few. Here's the handoff to Taylor. This time Friend drags him down after he gains first down yardage down to the 26-yard line.
I'm very impressed with Danny Friend from Morris at 6'5", 250. Now, Indiana recruited him as a tight end, but he's also going to play, I think he could play some linebacker for them, but that's just a nice job right here. You can see he takes on the block, spins out of the block to make the tackle. That's an outstanding football player overall, both defensively and offensively.
125 yards for Dimitri Taylor on the ground. Here's Gorgianis. Turns the corner, picks up about 5 or 6 yards there.
Nothing fancy about that either. He just took it. It was just a quarterback sweep to the wide side of the, actually running to the short side of the field. You can see it tuck right now. He's got a lead blocker out there. They're trying to string it out. He gets to the edge. You know, he picks up 4 or 5 yards. That's a good sound play. He's the better runner, even including Borsellino coming out of that spread formation.
Gorgianis ran for 5 touchdowns, 198 yards in the win over Marion Central.
They were all short touchdown runs, but they're still 5 touchdowns.
The fantasy players, it still all counts the same for them.
That's exactly right.
Taylor picks up a couple.
Well, you know, he filled in last year when John Rohde, the quarterback, went down early before the season ever started. They moved Gorgianis back to quarterback. He played throughout most of the year. They got him to the state championship game, and then Rohde's finger healed probably near the latter half of the season. He came back in, and then Gorgianis went back to wide receiver. Did the same thing this year early on when Wills was hurt in the fifth game of the year.
Broncos pretty good on third down here today, and they convert another one on the 10th play of this drive.
See, they're showing the consistency that they need to do. They're keeping Morris off balance, and the key is they're keeping those linebackers off balance. You can see how they pull and trap. They just run right up inside. 75, Tate Briggs doing a nice job.
Borsellino does a nice job of hanging on to the snap. Picks up a couple. Borsellino, the heart and soul of our team, according to Chris Andriano. We watched him grow up here. This is his third state championship game.
Well, having his father as the offensive coordinator doesn't hurt. Showing a lot of versatility. Sometimes I think, though, when they switch around a lot of quarterbacks, that the initial quarterback, Wills, in this case, doesn't get the rhythm when he's, you know, in and out every other play.
Keeps it himself, nobody open. He takes it down inside the 10 to the 8-yard line. Pick up a 5 for Wills, who suffered a concussion in week 7. So that's where the depth at quarterback comes in handy, when you got a guy that that gets hurt.
Well, that's where Gorgianis comes in the effect from last year and, of course, this year. But here's a job right here by Wills. Now, if he goes down, they got 2 other guys they can put in there. But getting back to the game plan of this, this is not what Morris expected to come out in the second half if they have Montini work the clock and work the field.
Borsellino, not much doing there.
But what he did
Craig
do is
Claire with the stop.
Excuse me, Lee. He brought the ball right into the middle of the field in case they want to go for a field goal, which I think they'll probably want to do. But that run was designed to go right in between the uprights. And that's exactly where the ball is being placed now for a field goal attempt. So there's always a thought process behind a play, depending on where you are and what the defense is giving you. Now, if they would have ran that play wide, the ball might have been on the right hash mark, which is, of course, a different angle than for the kicker. So, you know, you're playing into the strength of your game right now, and right now it's ball control for them and letting Andrew Hart pick up 3 points. Now, he missed one from this range earlier in the second quarter.
That's what is up and good for Andrew Hart, the All-State kicker. Makes it 16-0. Andrew Hart, the 6'1 senior, probably be kicking somewhere next year. 16-0 rather. Montini with the lead midway through the third quarter. We are back in Champaign. Montini, a 16-0 lead here in the third quarter, but Morris still believes that they will win. Arbimo Harris making it happen. Play of the game. It was the first play of the game. Andrew Taylor, 74 yards.
And this is just a great run by an outstanding running back who's been somewhat unheralded through this long run to the state championship game by Montini. But he's been really the glue that's kept this machine together with his offense from the inside. Now they have that vaunted passing game, but without Demetrius Taylor, they're not going to be here today, and they're not going to be in the position they are right now, up 16-0.
Yeah. Correct. Thanks for the correction. Demetri Taylor, not Anthony Taylor.
Hart will kick it off.
Looking right into the sun and off the Morris player.
They can't win for field position.
Hill, boy, it went right off of him.
That is
Kyle Hill had it go right off and looking right up into the sun. The sun has been pretty much inside the clouds all day and pops out there and gives Hill a little trouble. Lost it in the sun.
You know, you're up here and you're neutral as far as the teams, but I've got to kind of feel sorry for Morris. They just cannot for the life of them get field position. Here they have an opportunity and they bobble the kickoff.
They're lucky to have the ball.
They sure are. But this is now going to be dramatic as far as this first down play.
And you mentioned that Morris might go to a different look out of the old T formation, and they do here. Cinnamon finds a way through the line, picks his spot, and gets about 4 yards on first down.
Now Cinnamon again has not been a big rusher for them as far as the versatility if they were going to start coming out of the spread formation. He's carried the ball about 98 times running the ball this entire season for 459 yards and 10 touchdowns, which isn't too bad. But again, that's only a little over 7 carries a game and about 4.5 yards per average. So here they come in a different look.
Cinnamon looking to throw. Nothing there. Chased and brought down. Dylan Thompson in on the tackle.
Now something that's going to happen here is with Morris coming out in this formation, they're actually playing into the hands of Montini, because what does Montini run? They run the spread formation. What does Montini practice against all week long defensively for the most part is this particular look. So this is playing almost into the hands of Montini's defense to come out in this particular formation. And now they're looking at 3rd and 8.
Morris just 2 of 7 on third downs today.
Sometimes you can catch a team napping when you come out in a new formation in the second half, but not a team like Montini.
Pass is thrown behind the intended receiver. Anthony Munson was the intended receiver, and boy, it was very close to being picked off.
Very, very close. And again, we are so redundant this entire game by saying Montini's going to end up with excellent field position coming out of this kick. Now this is a smart play by Montini. Rather than have one receiver deep, they're putting two back there because they want to make sure they can handle the football rather than let it hit and get a bounce. They want to have it caught so they end up with good field position. That's the key. Catch it, and then everything after the catch is gravy. Here comes gravy.
Curry catching it at the 42 and takes it down to the 36. A return of 6 for Curry. 32-yard punt.
Field position, field position. There should be a stat on field position in the game, because you can become caught up in stats talking about yardages from passing and rushing, but you never know how where they occurred from. In this case, a start a drive from the 36.
Wills, a quarterback for Montini, leading 16-0. His pass is complete.
That was an excellent
route. And that's Gorgianis on the catch.
Excellent route. The slot man ran a little slant, and then the outside man ran the second slant behind him. And what that does is that clears the linebacker out and opens up a big gap between the linebacker and the corner for that slant.
And there's a look at that field position. Morris average starting position, their own 9. Montini, their own 46. That's a huge difference in this game. Here's Taylor. Waits for it, and takes it down to the 22, a pickup of 5.
Let's go downstairs now to Sophia Minnert.
Montini head coach Chris Rangiano spoke about his team's playoff run and said, we knew this run was going to be extremely difficult. We had that last second win against Sycamore, of course, going on the road versus Marion Central the week of Johnny Weiger's death. Of course, they had to come from behind against Joliet Catholic last week, but he said our kids have done a tremendous job of being mentally focused, guys.
Yeah, he says those close wins show what our kids are made of. And they are made of good stock. Gorgianis takes it and out of bounds near a first down at the 13-yard line.
That was an excellent job of blocking downfield by the other wide receiver, number 28, Tyler Tumpain, who just hung on the block right there. And that's a long block off of this jet sweep because it takes a long time to get there, which means he's got to be blocking all that much longer. But that was just an excellent job there, and he knew just exactly what he needed to do on that last little tiptoe in there to pick up the first down.
Alex Wills, quarterback, is lined up at receiver near side. It's Joe Borsellino behind center. Gives to Taylor, who he takes a couple of hard hits and doesn't get much there.
Now, sometimes when you get down in here, you can get a little too fancy. And, you know, obviously, Montini's been here long enough to know what it takes to get here. But sometimes it takes a little longer for when you do too much action in the backfield. That means that the offensive linemen have to sustain their blocks longer. And that's not that easy to do when you're going up against a defense like Morris possesses.
Borsellino in the Joe Cat. He's going to throw it this time to Gorgianis. He gets popped after a gain of a couple.
Good reaction by Morris getting over there. They pretty much know that once that those shoulders are turned and looked in one direction, the ball's going to be released. And they're biting on that particular move. They're flying to initially when he turns, that's the direction they're going. Watch how fast he turns, and they're flying to the football right there. Not only the linebacker, but the secondary coming up. That's a big play. It's not going deep for Montini. It's on the edges where they throw the bubble screens and the quick outs. It picks up all their yardage.
Gorgianis nursing that ankle a little bit as he got up.
Now we're looking at the full house backfield here by only out of the spread formation. Option.
Joe Cat keeps it himself.
Nice play.
Not much doing there. The tackle made by Brad Rickard for Morris.
That was just an excellent play by Rickard coming up and making that tackle, staying home. Because that's the first time they actually ran the option. And when you're going against a team that doesn't do it that often, sometimes you can break down as far as who has responsibility for what. That was just a good job. Somebody got on the pitch man and somebody on the quarterback. And again, Andrew Hart coming in for that field goal. And for him, it usually is a chip shot.
26-yarder. He is 1 for 2. Made the 28-yarder. And now Morris. This jumps offside. That's Grogan. Unless he was drawn, we might see a change in strategy.
There you go.
Oh, he was on Montini.
Now, see, that could have been a backbreaker for Morris, but it's not going to be hurt Montini that much. You can see there's a little movement that drew him off. But you're still well within range of Andrew Hart as far as a field goal is considered. But if had they picked up that first down, or excuse me, that penalty, then Montini might have changed and gone. Rather than looking for a field goal, they might have went for a touchdown.
So it goes from 26 yards to 31.
A challenge for most. But remember, his longest is 51 this year.
Good snap. Kick is good.
Hart makes it 19-0. Montini, the shutout intact for the Broncos as they go for their fourth straight state championship here in Champaign. Welcome back to Champaign. Montini, a 19-0 lead. Morris unable to get anything going offensively here in this one. Coming up next, we've got Cary Grove and Crete Moni for the 6A state championship. One of the top wide receivers in the country. Some say the number one wide receiver in the country. And then at 4 o'clock, it's Glenbard West against Lincoln Way East for the 7A state championship. Glenbard North and Mount Carmel wrap up a wild 2 days of football here in Champaign in the 8A state championship game.
There is some really good football to be seen the rest of this afternoon. I've had a chance to see all of those teams, and they are really outstanding high school football teams.
Hart kicks it into the end zone. It'll be first down and 10 from the 20 for Morris. The Redskins state championship tradition goes back to 1980. 1980, 1984, and then again 2005. Alan Thorson was an assistant coach on the 05 champs and in 07 for the second place team. He's trying to rekindle that Morris tradition here.
Well, what's interesting, Lee, is that that first state championship in 1980, that was in the 3A class. And then the next one that they had was in 1984, and that was 4A. And then the 6A championship in 2005. So they've moved along the classes as the expansion of the playoffs has occurred over the years. And Morris has had a traditionally great program. Obviously, this is their 10th time in the title game.
Cinnamon. Oh, flushed out of the pocket and sacked. Fred Bogard, Dylan Thompson in on the sack. A loss of 14.
Now that's where you tell your quarterback you have to get rid of the football. We cannot afford to lose 14 yards. Now again, he's in a situation he's not normally been in where he's now the catalyst for this offense. He needs to roll out of here. There's nothing there. Get rid of the football. Throw it out of bounds. That's just inexperience right there. Well, there it looks like they're committed to this spread in the second half.
Here's the draw. Perry with it. Picks up about six. Jeff Perry, the 6'3 senior.
Now, what's interesting is here you are in the state championship game. You're playing your 14th game of the year, and you're forced to get out of your comfort level that you've run for 14 games or 13 games coming into this, where you've run a couple of different formations but really have never run this for any length, or certainly where you need to count on it to win a state championship. So this is not a good comfort zone for Morris. And yet Montini sees this every day in practice.
They did go to this again, as we mentioned, against Washington and came up with that overtime win. Cinnamon out of trying to freelance now, running one way, now running the other. He steps out of bounds at the 25-yard line. Pickup of 12, but it'll still be short of the first down. Bring up fourth down for the Redskins, who have had awful field position all day and unable to move the ball against this Broncos defense.
Well, you can see right there one of the reasons why he tried to sprint out to the one side, and Montini will have nothing to do with it. They're stretching it out till they get help, and he has to cut back and then start Fran Tarkington around. Wow. And just a nice job by Montini. They just play good, solid defense.
Sir Francis, you're digging way back.
Way back. Whenever I see somebody scrambling around like that, and of course now you see that more often when kids are in the spread formation because there's so many great athletes back there.
Miracle to punt. End over end job. Curry
nice
fields it at the 44. Flag on the play. Curry steps out at the other 44-yard line.
I don't think that he.
Of 12.
Excuse me, Lee. I don't think he actually was in the game when that ball was snapped. He came running onto the field, and that's why that was such a spectacular catch, because he wasn't ready. I think he was not paying attention to down and distance, and/or T teammates were not yelling on the sideline, punt team up, waving that flag off, and I think Montini's very lucky on that one. See, sometimes I think you get in a big game like this and players that are not in there all the time get distracted. You can see right there somebody's telling them, you got to pay attention to what's going on. Now, I'm not accusing them of tweeting on the sideline, but you got to know if you're supposed to be back there catching a punt, it's going to be fourth down. Good field position again for Montini.
Gorgianis at quarterback.
Oh, they're putting a linebacker on Dimitri.
He's going to keep it himself. Ooh, a little straight arm action from Gorgianis. Right into the face mask of Mike McNellis. Actually, the side of his head, it looked like. Good straight arm, good old fashioned straight arm from Gorgianis. And that's how we wrap up the third quarter. Morris unable to get anything going here in our 5A title game.
The IHSA state football finals are proudly presented by Country Financial. Broncos in control, a 19-0 lead here at Memorial Stadium. Matt Rodewald with you here on the Moore sidelines, and the Redskins players are playing with heavy hearts throughout the season. Their friend Kyle Brown, who would have been a senior on this year's team, was tragically killed in a car accident as a passenger on I-57 back in May. And of course, they wanted to honor his memory. They have the jersey on the bench for him, and they have decals on his helmet. He would have been a running back, he would have been a linebacker. And when Alan Thorson was asked about Kyle, he paid the ultimate compliment by saying he was just one of the nicest kids I've ever coached.
All right, Matt, thank you very much. Yeah, that's, boy, that's tough. Both teams have lost teammates in the last year. Our hearts, thoughts go out to them. This pass play intended for Dusick from Alex Wills. He was wide open, just overshot him a little bit.
Well, and the corner bit on the little pump fake that he makes right there. And they run a post route, but they run a post route to make sure that the safety can't help him, and they get isolation with the cornerback. And he could tell right there that he overthrew him. Get a guy open like that, sometimes that's a tougher throw than trying to drill one in between two linebackers.
Joe Borsellino at quarterback. Give is to Taylor. Tries to bounce it outside and does. Flag on the play. Dimitri Taylor takes it to the 25, but that's probably coming back.
Well, that little spin move that he's done so well throughout this ball game got some extra yardage, but it could have resulted in a penalty for holding at Montini's offensive line. A lot of flags today, a lot of penalties for both teams.
Holding on the offense.
That's the ninth penalty against Montini.
Very, very uncharacteristic. And of course, if this wasn't the last game of the year, those would be things that you'd be talking to him about on Monday as far as cleaning those things up and different issues. But there's not a lot you can do about those kind of calls right now. That shows you how active Morris is as far as the offensive line from Montini are trying to grab onto him, because they're getting to the football so quickly, or fast flowing to the football, that Montini's getting a little frustrated as far as their offensive line is concerned.
Third and 15 for Montini, up 19-0. Alex Wills, a quarterback.
A little safety
belt. Borsellino at the 50. Oh, he was looking at Dusick, but Dusick stepped out of bounds, so that wouldn't have been a legal catch.
That was a good coverage downfield by the secondary of Morris, and that's why he went to his last cause down here, the safety valve. He's looking down the field and everything's taken, so he just pops it out here to the safety valve that's right on the edge, and Borsellino trying to set up his blockers, but he's not getting it. You can see a bend over backwards there. But interestingly, the first game of the year, Montini didn't know what they had in a quarterback, because Wills transferred from Wheaton Warrenville South to Montini at the end of the year. Oh, mercy. But getting
Jake Hogan had a little trouble with that
And then boy, the special teams haven't done him any favors either. A 44-yard punt.
Well, getting back to that quick story there, they didn't know what they had in the quarterback. And of course, they lost last year John Rode, who threw for almost 4,000 yards. And here's a bobble by Morris. And just special teams has really hurt him as far as handling the ball on both punt and kickoffs. But with Montini, they didn't know what they had in Wills. And in the first ball game, he came up with 320 yards throwing the football. So then they knew they had something after that first ball game.
Sobel nowhere to go. The theme of poor field position continues for Morris. We've seen their average starting positions been getting worse as the day's gone on.
Well, this is really what you call a nightmare, a real nightmare for Morris.
Much shorter field for Montini today.
Well, it has been, and everything is just a direct opposite of what Morris wanted and needed to happen in this game. They needed to run the football. They needed to control the clock. And what they needed to have is good field position, and they never, ever had that.
On second and 11, Wills looking for Friend, and he almost comes up with it. Cinnamon's throw just off the fingertips of Danny Friend.
That was a nice touch pass. It was right on the money. And Danny Friend, of course, had a bad angle on it. Danny, you could see just a little touch pass over here.
Tip. Still was going after.
Good hustle on his part.
He's a guy that's played tight end, defensive line, quarterback, and long snap for Morris this year.
Well, that's why he's going to Division I, University of Indiana. They can use some help, and he might be just the man to get him over the top. 6'5", 250.
Third and 11. Pass is complete to Perry and out of bounds at the 6. You talk about Friend going to Indiana University, Purdue, Minnesota, Oregon, some of the other schools that looked at him. Really wants to go there and try and help be a part of something special and get something started.
I'm kind of interested as to how many schools from the West Coast have. This year has been very unique, and how many have come in and looking at kids in the Illinois and Midwestern area. You know, you just mentioned Oregon. Well, they were looking at Treadwell, who will be playing in our game following this one, and several other players. So when they're coming, Southern Cal, going after Ty Isaac from Joliet Catholic.
Right.
I mean, over the years, you haven't seen that. West Coast schools coming into the Midwest to look for athletes from Illinois. But this year, we've had so many outstanding athletes that there's been an awful lot of West Coast people. And here's a good shot at what we're going to see this afternoon.
We will have some of those college guys watching Laquan Treadwell in the next game. Creek Moniz wide receiver going up against Kerry Grove in their run-based offense. In 7A, Glenbard West taking on Lincoln Way East, one of only two teams to beat Montini this year. And then you got the Caravan coming up in that final championship game of the day. Wills, little shuffle pass to Taylor. Flag coming back, holding against Montini.
They are just airing out their entire playbook today. They're not going to leave any page unturned going back up to Chicago after today. Just a little shuffle pass.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot. Replay, first down.
10th penalty, 79 yards in penalties against Montini, yet they lead it 19-0.
That's amazing. That's kind of gives you an idea of how important that field position is. They have that many penalties, but yet the key has been field position for them initially and none for Morris. But they certainly have used all the plays in their playbook. Last time they came out, they showed a little option. Now they did a little shuttle pass. What they're doing with that is because the linebackers are forced to go out and help out a little bit on the wide receivers because they are really spreading the field. They're going to isolate somebody here.
Wills takes the snap.
Draw
to Taylor. Taylor across midfield and down at the 45-yard line.
Now,
pickup of 12.
That was an excellent play by the defender that did not make the tackles. Just a draw here. What he does is he slows Taylor down right there. See him slow down till help arrives. So he didn't make the tackle, but he did a great job of breaking down and not lunging and letting him make moves on the run moving up the field.
148 yards rushing for Taylor.
Good throw.
Here's the pass complete to Tyler Tumpane. That'll be a first down for the Broncos.
That's Tumpane's first catch today. He again is one of those unheralded receivers in the arsenal and stable that Montini has.
Wills now thrown for 124 yards and a touchdown.
They're giving Morris's defense a lot of different looks and formations. There's an offside by the right tackle.
Ball start on the offense. 5 yard penalty.
Wow, 11 penalties. That's about a season's worth for Montini.
I kind of get a kick out of the back, walks up and kind of rubs his head, a helmet a little bit, as if that's going to help. You know, come on. There's Chris. Is not, I mean, he's happy when he looks at the scoreboard, but he's not happy with the polished product that he has produced up to this point.
It's kind of like a microcosm of their season. Nothing's been easy. It hasn't been a dominating trip to the state finals for Montini by any stretch of the imagination. But whatever it takes has been their motto, one of their mottos.
Oh, what a catch!
Oh,
almost
in and out of the hands of Tumpane. Thought he had it.
That was a good throw. It almost looked like he slowed up a wee bit. But interesting on your comment, Lee, about the trials and tribulations of Montini getting here throughout the year. This is just a nice touch pass. They're just isolating him right now one-on-one. And it looked like he had it. But Montini has never won with an undefeated season. In right. other words, this is they're going for their fourth straight state title, but they've never done it by being undefeated. So they've always had some trials and tribulations to get there.
Good point. Taylor on second down. Down to about the 30. Yeah, and that's. We'll get more into that in just a minute. Let's go downstairs to Sophia Minter.
Chris Andriano in our press conference earlier this week said, hey, our motto is we just know how to win. And by that, he said Montini football is just resilient, that we're just prepared for almost every situation, and gave a lot of credit to the kids and their work ethic, that they are the ones that have put in the time to know, you know, every game plan. And like you said, we just know how to win, and there's no quit in this Broncos team.
Yep, never say die attitude. And he says those tests just make his team better. And he really gives a nod to the coaching, and he wasn't patting himself on the back. He was talking about his assistant coaches and how they have helped these kids mature and get better, as Sophia mentioned, as they learn from those mistakes. And you probably know this from coaching as much as anybody. Kids learn more from losses and more from tough times than maybe they do when things go really well.
That's making the assumption that they have good coaches to help them learn them. And that's exactly what Montini has.
Right.
They have a strong coaching staff, and they learn from their mistakes. And that's why they always schedule tough opponents. That's why they schedule right away their first two games schools that are in the 8A class and 7A class. They schedule Palatine, who they beat in double overtime in the first game, and in their second game they scheduled Lincoln Way East, who is in the 7A state championship game. So they don't shy away from a tough schedule.
Hart's 47-yard attempt just short. Well, and getting back to your point about Montini and not winning state championships with perfect seasons, in 2009 they were 10-4. They finished 10-4. In 2010 they were 12-2. 12-2 last year. If they win here today, they would be 12-2.
Well, let me get you back to that that four loss season. They got into the playoffs with a 5-4 record that year that they won the state championship. So that gives you a perfect example of
right.
the concept that you're never done until it's over. And in their case, coming into it 5-4, nobody would have ever thought they would have won a state championship.
Cinnamon rolling out on first and 10, throwing it down the middle and almost actually through the hands of number 46 for Montini. That's Nicholas Sanzeri.
He's in a situation, Zach Cinnamon is in a situation that he hasn't been in all year long, and that's coming out of the spread formation and then getting pressure where he has to scramble and try and throw on the run. And he's just throwing it up for grabs here. The closest person to it was a Montini linebacker. So again, Morris is in unfettered territory here for their situation. It's 2nd and 10.
This is great field position for them, though.
It certainly has been.
Here's Perry with it. Perry, the All-Stater on the defensive side of the ball, headed to Central Michigan.
another Division I recruit for the Redskins.
And that's something that has not happened very often in this second half at all for Morris is first downs.
Just their first down of the second half, only their sixth overall in the game.
That truly is amazing statistic to go along with the poor field position they've had this entire game.
6:44 to go in this one. Cinnamon almost brought down behind the line of scrimmage and then makes it back there before he's tackled.
Fred Bogard, number 58. He's one of the captains, defensive lineman, 6'3", 245. Good penetration. Coming up at the top right here. He has nothing to do. He's backside contained, and he does the job right there. Now, he's a young man that's got a lot of MAC schools looking at him, some Big Ten schools. So Montini has a lot of athletes that have a lot of different universities looking at them as far as what kind of an athlete they are and if they can play football at the next level. And they've got enough of those that have put them in this ballgame. Boy, he's getting the time.
Nobody open. The coverage outstanding by the Montini backfield. And Fred Bogard is there for the sack. A coverage sack there.
Coverage sack there. Dylan Thompson gets in on it at 6'6", 260. Good shot right there of Fred Bogard. Thompson, they've got a tough defensive front four between Kennedy, Thompson, Ruano, and Bogard.
I mean, this is a Montini defense that allowed 37 points against Palatine, 49
first
to Marion Central.
On the defense, 15-yard penalty.
I'd probably think that something like that could be a possible taunting or whatever, but you can see right there there's a little good shot of Thompson and Bogard. But by having a tough front four like that, that really frees up your linebackers to help in run support, but also in pass coverage, because you can rely on that defensive front to put pressure on the quarterback.
Cinnamon, the transfer from Streeter, back to throw, forced out of the pocket again. He's going to have to keep it himself. Nobody open, and he crosses midfield. And that might be only the second time this game that Morris has been across midfield, going back to their first drive on the long run by Sobel.
Well, the difficult part there for Cinnamon is he's scrambling out of there. He tucks the ball immediately. Well, when he does that, that brings up the secondary. Watch the tuck right in there. Now the secondary is going to start rolling up because they know now he's no threat to throw the ball. If he runs with the ball a little bit more, even if he gets two and past the line of scrimmage, that'll keep the secondary playing softer and not allow them to come racing up to make some plays. But now they're looking at second and five at midfield, someplace they haven't been all day.
Cinnamon had a 56-yard touchdown run against Sacred Heart Griffin. He tucks it under again. He's got some room to maneuver here, down to about the 36-yard line. That's a pickup of 12 for Zach Cinnamon. So they've found a little bit of something to work here. A little ad-libbing when the coverage has been good for Montini. Cinnamon's been able to make something happen with his feet.
Well, and it, part of that is that front four is putting pressure on him, and there's good coverage downfield. But with 5:20 left in the clock and 19 down, this is not Morris's forte.
Cinnamon's pass in and out of the hands of Danny Friend, incomplete, and our good friend and statistician Dave Bergson tells us this is the third time that Morris has been across the 50 this game.
Well, again, here's pressure, and what's good is that he's dumping on just a drag route right across underneath the line of scrimmage and between the linebackers. But Montini has such faith in their front four as far as the pass rush. Their linebacker, they haven't stunted the entire day. The linebackers drop right into coverage immediately if pass shows, and or they're allowed to scrape on run. So that front four has done a great job for Montini the entire afternoon.
Cinnamon looking down the middle, has a man. It's complete. And that was Munson. Anthony Munson, one of the receivers with the catch.
Now, we talked about him in the open, and this is the first opportunity we get a chance to talk about. We talked about him being the free man. You can see him get right behind the linebacker there and then get in that dead spot and try to cut back. He's 6'1", 205. He's their go-to guy when they're throwing the football.
Here's Jeff Perry still on his feet. Boy, great second effort down inside the 10-yard line, down to the 8.
Now, that's the type of running that Morris is used to by their running backs in the way that they punish tacklers. Clock's going to continue to run with 4:50. This will be good for Morris to get the ball in the end zone. It's always good for a high school football player and team not to be shut out in the state championship game. And I've done a lot of them, and I don't really care one way or another who wins, but I just don't like to see anybody shut out.
Well, the question comes then, if people might wonder, well, where has this been all game for Morris?
Well, there's a lot of, for example, right here, you can see the pressure right here as far as throwing the football, but Morris is doing something they're not used to doing. Right now they're playing ad lib football. They're playing off the cuff. This is not what they do normally. They haven't done this for the last 13 games. This is what they've done right here. Full house tee, power football.
Ooh, Harry met right the line of scrimmage. We could hear that hit all the way here upstairs.
And that was an on block Mike Matico right here. You can see he's playing corner. He closes it down right there. Because of the formation, he didn't have any responsibilities in the secondary. He's a 5'10", 185-pound junior corner. He just closed down and made the tackle.
Third down.
Nice job.
Cinnamon to throw. Looking into the end zone, knocked down and well defended there by Montini.
It was going to Danny Friend.
Ryan Starbeck on the coverage.
That was just a one-man route. And so by one-man route, that put two to three defenders on him. They know that Danny Friend is the big target right here. You can see the defenders right there. Now, granted, he's a 6'5 target, but it's tough when you've got two to three defenders on you.
Well, we got fourth and goal from the six. The Redskins will go for it down 19-0. Cinnamon in the shotgun. And here come the Broncos. Fred Bogard leading the charge for the defensive line, and Cinnamon slow to get up.
They were totally outmanned right there. The five offensive linemen had seven defenders coming after them. A lot of pressure.
Fifth sack of the game for Montini. It's all Broncos. And we are back in Champaign. Montini leading 19-0. Time running out here in the fourth quarter as they go for their fourth straight state championship. Our KFC player of the game, Dimitri Taylor, 156 yards rushing and a touchdown. Two catches, 62 yards and a touchdown.
He set the tempo right off the bat, the very first play for Montini from the line of scrimmage. And then he just can show his versatility coming out of the backfield right down the middle of the field. Then it's watch me run with the football. This is what he does, and he does it extremely well.
Chris Andriano says Dimitri Taylor packs a wallop, but he is so elusive, he didn't really have to hit anybody. Under 4 minutes to go now. Georgianis will keep it. He's getting out to first down yardage, steps out just past the marker.
That's not what Chris wants him to do. He wants him to get to the marker and stay in bounds.
And in keeping with that theme of close calls we were talking about, Jack, it started in week one, a 40-37 overtime win against Palatine. Week eight, they beat Aurora Christian 31-27. That Sycamore overtime or a game went to the last second. They won on a last second field goal. In JCA, they were down 14 with 3 minutes to go in the third quarter. It has been a theme all season long as Taylor takes it out to the 36-yard line, but that has really toughened and steeled this team against just about everything this year.
Well, it really has, and of course, you know, Morris had a great season, obviously, to get to this point also, and they just run up against some bad luck today. Morris is an excellent football team, but field position has been, you know, we can be so redundant talking about that, but if we were to replay this game every single time that they've had the football, they've been in their own territory. They just haven't had a good opportunity, and the scoreboard has indicated that.
Taylor with the carry here as the Broncos will work a little clock as we approach the 3 minute mark. Coming up, Kerry Grove playing for the 6A state championship. Going up against Crete Moni. We will have that one for you
coming up next. They can't wait, neither can we. Looking forward to that ball game. 7A and 8A to follow, so don't go anywhere. Stay with us here in Champaign.
There are some great talent in that game, and we're going to see a lot of things that a lot of our fans at home have not seen at the high school level in this upcoming football game. And for the remainder of the afternoon, some great football games coming up with some outstanding football teams.
Taylor the carry as he adds to his total 162 yards. He had 156 yards in the win against Joliet Catholic, 156 on the ground, 55 receiving, 3 touchdowns total. And on the game-winning play, when Joe Borsellino ran it in for the touchdown in the comeback win over Joliet Catholic, Taylor turned to Borsellino and said, "Follow me to state."
Well, follow
me.
That's
exactly what he did.
Follow me to state and then hop on my shoulders.
That's right.
Because I'm going to get the trophy for you, and he certainly has done that. And we've got wholesale substitutions for both teams here. Coming in with a timeout by Montini because they were substituting the entire offensive front. But point well taken with that. Montini has had a lot of different heroes all year long. Somebody has always come up to the forefront. If there's an injury here, Borsellino took over. If there's an injury somewhere else, Georgiannis took over. It's just been one of those where everybody has done their part and more. And of course, in Morris's case, good, solid, tough football, which they're known for, is solid offensive line play and tough defense.
Montini will kick it away here with 2:09 to play and a 19-0 lead. Fair catch called for and made by Jake Hogan. And the other hero we haven't talked about is the defense for Montini, pitching a shutout here. 5 sacks, 3 of them for Fred Bogard on that defensive line. There's Bogard again. Cinnamon and the Morris Redskins forced to try and throw the ball to get back into this game, and Montini's defense would have none of it.
Well, that's what they wanted to do coming into the ball game, was to force Morris. You always want to take them out of their comfort zone, whoever you're playing. That's part of a game plan, one of the initial parts, take them out of their comfort zone. And that's exactly what Montini did.
Here's the give to Perry. Again, we mentioned he's headed to Central Michigan on scholarship. And he, you know, they talk about that Morris tradition. And Jeff Perry said, "Since I was a little guy watching the 05 and 07 teams come to state, this was my dream." And made it to state. They're not going to take home a state championship trophy. They're going to take home second place. But that's still quite an accomplishment and adding to that Morris tradition.
Well, for these kids that are down in this field and in uniform for
Cinnamon.
Both teams. Nice run.
Down inside the 40 and steps out of bounds at the 34-yard line.
This is what memories are made of. You know, there's a lot of different things you can talk about, but playing in a state championship game is something you'll remember the rest of your life. Here's just a great job of scrambling right here and cutting back against the grain and have enough idea here to get out of bounds, stop the clock. Again, decent field position with a minute 30 left. They get a chance to get on the board.
24-yard pickup for Cinnamon. What a job he's done coming in. You know, you talk about Alex Wills coming in as a transfer. Same deal for Zach Cinnamon. He had 2 touchdowns in the upset win over Minooka in week 1. They knew they had a guy that was going to lead them all year long. He had 2 touchdowns in the game overtime win against Washington. So some key plays for him along the road to Champaign.
Well, and the backgrounds are a little different. Obviously, you mentioned coming from Streeter where they hadn't won, and then but from Wills coming from Wheaton South, but said all they did is win.
Right.
And there's their motto. Every time they put their hands in the air after a break or coming out of a huddle, that's what they said was four-peat, and that is something that they've been able to accomplish.
Cinnamon throw complete to Perry. He's inside the 20 now.
Oh,
makes
he's going to go. He's going to there break that shutout.
There it is. Morris on the board in the final minute. 33 yards. Cinnamon to Jeff Perry on the touchdown.
Good for Morris. Never give up, never quit. That's high school football at its finest right there. kids that come down, they don't look at the scoreboard. We want to get in the end zone. We want to do the best they can. Just a middle screen right here, dumps it over the top. You can see right here, he just does a nice job of running. Not showing great speed, but doing a good job of getting behind his people downfield and gets into the end zone. This is a big score for Morris.
Perry, 7 rushing touchdowns on the year coming into the game.
Go for two
here.
Crossing route. You got it? No.
Well, they say it's incomplete to Friend, and Cinnamon's slow to get up. He's had a pretty tough day back there.
Well, I'm sure last night, before Zach Frem closed his eyes, he wasn't thinking that he would be the mainstay of Morris's offense today, because it hasn't been the case all year long. And he didn't probably feel as if that he'd be throwing the ball as often as he has today. And that's been quite often, but you got to give credit for Montini to force him into that situation.
Got a good crowd today.
So the Montini lead now 19-6 with 47 seconds to play. And now you try and put in perspective where this puts Montini among the great programs, and Chris Andriano, when you mentioned him with names like Gordy Gillespie and Matt Seffner and Frank Lenti and those kind of guys, Tim Rackey from Driscoll Catholic, that's built a program and really done it here in recent years. And this will be their 4th straight state championship and their 5th overall since 2004.
Well, those are names that I'm sure Chris knows all of those guys. And all of those coaches combined would say the same thing. It's not me, it's right. The players that played for me that got me to this status. And sure. The kids always remember who the coach was, but the coach always remembers the type of players that got them there.
Not to mention all those assistant coaches who go day after day. And you know, like we've talked about before, this isn't a seasonal sport anymore. I mean, you go year round with weightlifting and 7-on-7. And
well, really, if you go back to it right now, I mean, when you're in this case like with Montini, it really is a full time job because they finish Thanksgiving weekend. So what will happen in their case, they'll give them till probably after Christmas, and they come back after break and they'll start lifting the whole time then through spring. And then summer comes and it's weights again, and it's summer camps, 7-on-7s. It is, as you mentioned, it's a year round, I don't want to say job in high school, but
right.
You know, kids have to pay the price to get to this level and to be able to hoist that trophy up over their head. Congratulations to Morris for a tremendous season. And for Montini, bringing that motto come through for Chris Andriano right there. Great season for both football teams.
Tough day for Morris. They were faced with a long field all day long. Awful field position, and Montini really set the stage on that first play, the Dimitri Taylor touchdown run from 74 yards out. Montini led all the way as they pick up their 4th straight state championship for Chris Andriano and the Montini Broncos.
Well, it's kind of interesting as you look through the stand to see one side and how excited they are, another state championship. And Morris, who's been here, this is their 10th time Morris has been down here. They're going home with 2nd place, but still the chance to play in the state championship game is just a tremendous goal for any football player that puts those pads and the helmets on right in the beginning of August. I mean, that's the immediate goal. You can talk about winning the conference, and you can talk about gaining 1,000 yards, and you can talk about being all conference, but they all talk about wanting to get to Champaign. Sometimes it's beyond realism, and it's just a fantasy, but you never know. Dreams are made of this kind of thing.
Well, the other thing about Chris Andriano that we've found over the years and talking to him and covering him, he produces great football teams, great football players, but he also produces really good young men, and you know that they're getting lessons beyond just the football field from this coach.
Well, that's what it's all about, and I always like to look at the academic stats of these young men also.
Let's go downstairs to Sophia.
Coach Chris Andriano, congratulations. You were worried about a slow start, so how big was Taylor's opening touchdown?
Well, DT really got us off to the start that we were hoping for, and of course, when you play a physical team like a Morris, you need to make sure you get some things established up front right away. So I was happy that our lines on both sides of the ball, I thought, played really well early. And I thought that was pretty much a big key, you know, that we needed to make sure that we could control the ball, and we got a couple of big plays out of DTs. It was a great effort from our kids.
Defensively, you allowed Morris to cross midfield just three times. What can you say about their effort?
Wow, I didn't realize that, but I knew that we were playing a good game. Our defense has been bend and not break. Well, we didn't even bend today. Our kids were awesome today. Great game plan by our defensive coaches. Our D coordinator, Mike Bukowski, always does a great job. And, you know, our kids on the defensive side of the ball, sometimes I think they take a little heat because the offense gets all of our credit. But those kids played a great game today. That was an awesome display defensively.
Coach, congratulations. The four-peat is complete for Montini. Matt, over to you.
All right, Sophia, and for Demetri Taylor, you know, you're here last year, 200 yards. Nobody even noticed because they put 70 on. Coach said that people really don't know how good you are. Do they know now?
Yeah, I believe people now know my true abilities, and I've also known that all my life, and I guess they now know too.
Tell me about that catch and run that you had in the second quarter, a nifty spin move to get to the end zone.
Well, I knew I had to catch the ball and do what I had to do, and I seen that they had a linebacker on me, and I truthfully believe that no linebacker in state can, like, keep up with the speed that I have, and I knew that I was going to be successful with it.
You get another state championship, and you've been a part of a couple of these. Can you describe the meaning of Montini's legacy now with the state football in Illinois?
I believe we finally made a statement out there to everybody in Illinois, and I believe that, like, we're all out there on top and nobody can bring us back down.
All right, Demetri Taylor, another big day here on this field. Guys, send it back to you.
All right, Matt Rodewald, thank you very much. Yeah, what a great day. 165 yards rushing. Demetri Taylor leading the way for Montini as they win their fourth straight state title. And welcome back to Champaign. Montini, the 19-6 win over Morris. The Broncos are your 5A state champions, fourth straight state championship. And the Broncos and Redskins get ready to receive their trophies. You've been in this situation. Tell me what's going through the mind. What kind of, I mean, obviously a lot of joy on one side.
Well, what happens is you're really on cloud nine for the young men and coaches that have just won the state championship. I mean, you've worked so darn hard to get here, it's almost hard to believe it's become a reality. I mean, here it is. We started this weightlifting and, you know, in wintertime and then throughout the summer in that 90-degree heat, and all of a sudden now you're cold and you're freezing. But, you know, you forget all about that now, and all of a sudden it's like it's finally here. And then on the other side of the coin, you work so hard to get here, and yet It didn't turn out to be that case for us. This is the toughest one right here, is to get that trophy right there and those medals. Now, by that I mean right now, in
right,
the moment.
Right.
5 years from now, 10 years from now, it'll be a whole different issue. But right now, this is the toughest moment for him, second place. It won't be at the reunion in 10 years or, you know, 20 years from now. But for kids that have worked this hard for this long, it is a big, big disappointment.
It's another big trophy to take back home to Morris. You look back just to the last 15 appearances, 1994, second place, 2001, second, 2004, second, and again in 2007. So there's
this is their seventh second place trophy they're taking home out of 11 trips down here.
A lot to be proud of.
You can't win it if you don't get here.
That's right. A large number of schools would give anything to just have that opportunity to play here on the turf and compete for a state championship.
That certainly tells you something about a program, though. When you're down here 11 times, that is just an amazing statistic, and it certainly is a credit to the coaches and the players and the community for that support that they've given them.
One of the great football communities in Illinois, Morris. Those guys have been playing together since they were in fifth and sixth grade. They talk about the closeness of their team and how they've worked together all those years, all those summers, all those winters in the weight room like you talked about.
When you walk down those hallways and you see those names and you recognize those names from the community, you know, that was somebody else's uncle and somebody else's dad and all those kind of things. And when you're at the basketball, and you're walking through the hallways, going to a basketball game, and you see the trophies, and you see all those All-Staters up there, and the pictures of the teams that got down here. Everybody knows everybody in a community like that. And it's very close-knit. It's got a tremendous reputation for football throughout the Chicagoland area and the state of Illinois and in the Midwest. Of course, there's a sign that some people might say would be a little, I don't want to use the word arrogant or cocky, but, you know, you got to put that sign up there. You got to believe in something.
That's right.
And that became their motto and their slogan. And they got to it.
That was their motivator all year long. And they come through with it here today. You look at Dimitri Taylor and Joe Borsellino.
They've had a lot of pieces to the puzzle fall into place for them to have this happen. And you can see the excitement right there. They're raising another one. Then it'll always come down to which was the best team coach that you had down here. You know, every time he'll go to a reunion, those kids will be asking, what was the best state championship team you had? And of course, Chris is very political, and he'll just say each one was the best. They had their, in their own way, they had their own different personality.
And those young men were chanting Johnny Weiger's name, their teammate, who they lost to leukemia earlier this year. So even in their biggest moment, they were remembering that young man. That says a lot about this team. And there's their leader, Chris Andriano, four straight state titles. All right, we are going to take it to a break. We've got 6A state championship football coming your way. Congratulations to Morris on a great season. They finished 12-2. Montini, your fourth straight state championship, 19-6 the final.